Hi, I'm Nathan.
I'm Cameron.
And this is DeBarino.
And we're we're the commentators. We're watching Marvel's Captain America, The Winter Soldier, a.k.a. Captain America 2, a.k.a. I'm in love with Chris Evans. No, wait.
Yes, you are.
I am.
You know, as opposed to it being anybody else's Captain America, The Winter Soldier.
Mm-hmm.
Now,
Not the Incredible Hulk, The Winter Soldier.
Yeah. Now, this opening weekend we're recording it, this is the opening weekend of Avengers Age of Ultron.
So very appropriate.
Mm-hmm.
We're watching a Marvel movie.
And I haven't seen either. I haven't seen this film, and I haven't seen Avengers Age of Ultron.
Because you're too busy spending years coming up with the nickname DeBarino.
Yes.
This is a great bit.
I love that they brought back the theme from the first Captain America movie for this beginning, because I love the music in the first Captain America. It's great.
And I love that this movie has the Falcon. When I was growing up, the Falcon was Cap's sidekick. I mean, I didn't even know that there was a Bucky. I just knew that there was Captain America and the Falcon, and he was badass.
I mean, Anthony Mackie.
Mackie is great as Sam Wilson, a.k.a. the Falcon.
A.k.a. Marvel needed another black guy in their series.
A.k.a. shut your mouth, he's awesome.
He is awesome, but they needed a little more diversity in their series.
And I'm going to say it right now, sorry Tumblr fangirls, you know, Falcon's better than Bucky.
Uh-oh.
Well, that's mainly because, you know, Tumblr fangirls, you know, when you look on Tumblr for art, like, you know what, I want to see a good picture, you know, I want to see a good picture of Captain America and Bucky, and you'll get those, then you'll get them of Captain America and Bucky fucking. I like this bit, too, of, like, what it's like to be a soldier.
Because even though he's 90 whatever years old, he can still relate to people, which is good. And I loved that he was kind of joking about what things used to be like. This is the best, one of the best. I don't call it a gag, but one of the best parts coming up is the list.
Yeah, the list that he has. Him trying to catch up.
Oh god,
that's a great idea.
That's awesome. He just
look at all.
Yeah, look at Star Wars, Trek, Thai food, Nirvana, band.
Oh.
I loved the people would post fake versions of that, and they would all be like, two girls, one cup, and then I.E. Tony, LOL, ? You know, stuff like that.
Bob the Clown.
Yep, and once again, it's one of those things where it is a recurring theme throughout the commentaries that we do. And that is for the films that we, you know, we do like or admire, what have you. That is the little touches that really do.
There's a little touch right there that I like.
I knew that was coming.
I want my goddamn Black Widow movie. Like, Scarlett Johansson, I feel like, has been on a genuine role since at least Avengers. It was this, Winter Soldier, Under the Skin, Lucy, and now Avengers 2. She's on a roll.
Mm-hmm. Now, I gotta say, one of the things that really pissed me off when I first started seeing, like, pictures and whatnot, this movie, so they showed Captain America's shield. And they took away the red.
Aww.
And I'm like, that's fucking bullshit.
And then you
fuck this movie. I fucking hate it. Before I had even seen
it.
And then you see this and it's like, okay, well, it was only for the beginning part.
It's a stealth
sheet. And it was only because it's nighttime, it's dark, he has to be more stealthy, he doesn't want anything to really stand out. So he can get away in the dark. It's like, it makes sense.
I just like the idea that his shield is normal every other time. It's like, stealth mission, I need to paint it now.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, everything you just said is almost the exact reaction I had when they showed it, when they showed tatted up Jokers. I like to call them the Juggaloker.
That's one of the things, since we're watching a comic book movie, we can discuss a little bit.
And we're also recording on the day of the comic book day.
Yeah. And you know what? I'm glad to say that apparently Juggaloker, with the inks and the fucked up grill to the point he looks like he could be he could sing that song, you know, what was it? Butterfly? You're my butterfly, baby. He looks like the lead singer of that fucking band. Apparently, that wasn't the real Joker. Like, that's not what he's going to look like.
Which kind of disappointed me.
No, you know what?
Because so many people were bitching about it, and then they're like, well, it isn't really the Joker. And I was like, oh, darn it, I wanted to hear more people bitch and complain about it when the movie opened.
It was awful.
I wanted to... You know, I gotta say, I liked it in a way, simply because it was completely different than anything else we've seen before. As a joke, I was like, okay, they're doing a completely different take on it. Now, and I like that the fact that they have the balls to do that. But now they're like, backtracking.
No, there's a difference when you're having balls to do something. And first of all, this sequence, jumping from a plane without a parachute, is taken out of Mark Millar's The Ultimates. That's the first comment that comes to mind. Cap has probably done it before.
Cameron's a nerd.
Cameron's
a nerd.
They did change it a bit because Mark Millar's Ultimate, which, you know, for some reason Captain America and everything is, you know, the testosterone is turned up to 12. Mm. Somebody says, "Is Captain America just jump out of the plane without a parachute?" Yeah, he thinks parachutes are for girls.
Well, I'm going to say this from what I've seen so far. I've seen better shots and angles than a Joss Whedon movie.
Are you on a tear against Joss Whedon right now?
Here's the thing. I like the first Avengers film. I do. But that was great.
That looked so brutal.
But I just like how it's like it's done, especially that one shot there that you just saw him like you felt like you're right there watching.
I love
this
little bit right here. Yeah. He's just running up, nice wide shot. Boop, bye.
that's a great callback, right?
But now some stuff like this is where it starts to lose me a little bit. It's way too much handheld shaky cam shit, and
you know
I hate
what?
It.
See, that's the thing. After going through the incomplete and utter fucking nightmares of the latter two Bourne movies, Paul Greengrass that did them, mm-hmm. with that shaky cam, horrible
ass.
That's
how it all got started.
This is so mild compared to that.
That's true.
Because
it still bothers me, though. And Joss Whedon started doing it in Age of Ultron. It's too much shaky cam shit in that movie.
Oh, and by the way, I'm going to say this. Fuck the Bourne movies after the first one.
I love those Bourne movies, by the way.
Fuck them. Because, well, I know why. Because I cannot. If I can't follow the action in an action movie, you're fucked. You're fucked.
That was good. I like that.
No, there's great little moments, great little bits like that throughout this movie that I love.
Now, back to the Joker thing. That's not balls. That's stupidity. That's not balls. It's the same kind of stupidity as, you know, saying, "Hey, let's make Dr. Doom a fucking blogger," because. What he looked like in that picture wasn't the Joker, but one of the people that Batman fights to get to the Joker. One of Joker's thugs.
One of his thugs?
Yeah.
The thing that threw me about the tattoos was, I'm not necessarily against the Joker having tattoos, but when I see the Joker with tattoos, the first image that comes into my mind is Joker having to go into a tattoo shop and get someone to put tattoos on him. And that's just an image that doesn't really mesh. Like, you're that mass murdering psychopath that Batman's always trying to capture. What can I ink you up with?
The hilarious thing was, like, the people who were so in love with it, who are obviously also huge Linkin Park fans, were trying to say, like, no, man, you probably got him in prison. I've seen prison tattoos.
Those do not look
those are not prison tattoos. And not only that, but Joker doesn't go to prison. He goes to Arkham. There are no tattoo artists in Arkham. You think anybody's going to trust any of those lunatics with a staple, let alone a fucking anything to make a tattoo gun?
I'm going to say this. This is a better action sequence than anything Joss Whedon's ever done.
You hate Joss Whedon.
I don't. It's not that I don't hate. I like Joss Whedon. It's just that Joss Whedon is not the best filmmaker in the world in terms of when it comes to how he frames his shots at times. There's some really good
people
moments.
Think I'm baiting the fanboys
on Yeah, it's like, no, here's the thing though. Bear in mind, I do like the Avengers, but I think the Avengers succeeds in spite of Joss Whedon's direction. That the actors are so good that it works.
Are you slightly comparing Joss Whedon to George Lucas?
Oh, no. No, because, well, to be fair, George Lucas on a great day, I'm talking Star Wars, THX-1138, American Graffiti, is far better than anything Joss Whedon's ever made.
I would definitely argue that point.
If we're talking like Joss Whedon now and George Lucas now, then there's
no if we're talking George Lucas even at the height, I highly argue that point.
I can't. It's one of those where it's just for me.
Just because the more I watch, especially when it comes to Star Wars, everyone like goes, "Oh, the best of Star Wars movies are." And this is the way it's ranked 90% of the time. It goes Empire, Star Wars, Jedi. I would go Empire, Jedi, Star Wars.
And Nathan,
I wouldn't go either one of those routes.
You'd go Star Wars, Empire, Jedi.
For me, it's 1, 2, 3.
Yeah,
that's the way the trilogy go for me.
So, Phantom Menace, Attack of the Clones.
Yes,
and
exactly.
Avengers.
That's exactly what
God,
I mean.
Why is there no solo Black Widow movie? She's fucking great.
Because they're afraid it won't sell.
Oh, fuck.
Fuck them for thinking it won't
Look
sell.
Look at that ass. That's what I was talking about when I said, oh, fuck.
Okay, seriously, imagine a James Bond movie with somebody doing all that cool James Bond shit, but it's also Scarlett Johansson.
Mm.
Okay?
Yes,
was it
please.
Called Lucy?
No, Lucy's great. You know, despite, you know, no, the science fiction stuff, dude.
Oh, jeez.
This entire sequence reminds me of the second level of Splinter Cell Chaos Theory.
Oh,
when he goes
oh,
on
good
shit.
Point.
Something about it. I was like, I feel like I'm playing Splinter Cell right now a little bit.
And I can't. I just want to finish the thoughts on the joke because the thing is, anybody who was like, oh man, that just shows how messed up and psycho he is. First of all, anybody who tattoos the word damaged on their foreheads trying to
that was fuck, a that was a bit on the nose.
They're trying too fucking hard.
Everything else was they were subtle tattoos, but that was a little on the nose.
And here comes a someone who's an underrated cat villain, probably because of his shitty name and kind of shitty costume in the comics. His name is Batroc the Leaper.
What?
The Leaper?
Yeah, but he is a martial arts expert in a god. There's this French martial art.
He is leaping a lot.
Batroc.
Like bat. Bat rock.
Bat rock. Bat rock.
It's all
yeah,
it's B A T
Roy Batty
B A T R O C Batroc.
Barth following me.
Now see, I love these wide shots that they're getting, but then they get up close and it's all just shaking around and going crazy and my eyes start to hurt. It's like
I like this part too. Where they're speaking in French and he's trying to be all, oh, I thought you were more than the shield, yeah, blah 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 blah. And then
now his hair would not be that perfect if he was just wearing that helmet. No.
Oh, that was great.
He says in the French, too. Actually, I dispute that. You want to know why? Because he's Captain fucking America.
That's true. He is Captain.
Just like, you know, when I watched that on Mythbusters James Bond special and started busting all those myths, I said, they're forgetting one important fact. He's James fucking Bond.
Yeah. You have to enter that into the equation. Yeah.
But his name is Batroc the Leaper. He has a silly ass costume in the comics. But what he is is capoeira? Is that a capoeira? Is a French martial art? It's this one where like it's heavy on kicking and just staying in motion.
Mm-hmm.
And he's an expert in that. He's always one of the best fighters in Marvel.
Hey, be quiet! Scarlett Johansson is bending over.
Oh yeah, you can't hear her bending over.
So I guess we're adding Scarlett Johansson to our great great ass list. So we have
Scarlett Johansson. We're gonna add Scarlett Johansson to the great everything. Okay, she's got a sexy ass voice. She's definitely got a healthy good body, and it doesn't hurt that she knows what she's doing. She's on camera. She knows what the fuck she's doing.
I'm actually kind of glad that her career is definitely going through this great second revival.
Yeah.
You also mentioned, did you mention her as well?
No, I forgot to mention her, but her's great too.
Yeah.
Because it kind of seemed like she went through the kind of same thing that Matthew McConaughey went through, where she kind of broke big, and then it was romantic comedy after romantic comedy.
Was it? What were the romantic comedies?
I know that there was, In Good Company with Dennis Quaid.
Oh, that one. What about the one of the oh, screw it. The ensemble one with Jennifer Goodwin and Bradley Cooper.
Yeah.
Where Bradley Cooper had a choice between Jennifer Connelly and Scarlett Johansson. Why not both?
This is a little girl in the taco commercial. Why not both?
Yay! Yay!
But one of the things about the Joker's design is...
Oh, there's a nice ass shot right there.
Is,
oh, look at that.
Woo!
Oh, Chris Evans,
look
please.
Look at that eye.
Yes.
Look at that ass. Look at those pecs. Look at that everything.
Look at that eye patch.
Look at that bullet.
Look at that
head.
Eye patch. Oh.
No. But I know it will stand by the George Lucas directing him when he was in his prime was better than anything Joss Whedon could do.
What about just in feature films or what about television?
Just anything. It's like
I
have to
different worlds?
Yeah, because one else where I have to clarify to the audience that the thing is I don't think I'm not going to go as far as think Joss Whedon is a bad writer or anything like. No, I don't. Does he have his little tropes and what have you? That I think sometimes he lays it on real thick. Yes, I do. But
constant pop culture references.
Constant pop culture references, stuff like that. But
that's one of the things about the first Avengers movie is...
A little bit
too. He has references to the fact that he has references in the movie.
Yeah.
Which is a little... it's a little much, but it still makes me chuckle.
But the one thing was he did the screenplay for Cabin in the Woods, which is a film I really did like. Oh, and I thought...
Didn't he write it with Drew Goddard?
Yeah, and Drew Goddard directed that. So I think that... he is a capable writer. I just think that sometimes he should get somebody else to direct his scripts. Yeah, it happens sometimes. It's sort of like, to go back to George Lucas, I think that George Lucas is a great producer, a great idea man. It's just that he needs other people.
He needs to surround himself with.
Yes, exactly. Surround himself by talented people to really, you know, take the idea and go a step ahead.
And here we go, where Nick Fury further... Yeah. Places Cap's trust in him in question.
Yep. And that's the one.
It's the scene with the giant helicarriers.
Yeah. But the one thing that I really did like when it comes to how Chris Evans portrays Captain America is that he questions things. That he's actually a lot smarter than he looks because he was, for all intents and purposes, a nerd before he joined the army.
And,
right.
And not only that, but he's also kind of he is living proof that when it comes to war. Governments are willing to try anything.
Yeah.
He's the lone man standing for truth, justice, and the American way.
Yeah, and
more
and,
so than some other superheroes.
Yeah,
who should be like standing for those same things.
Yeah, like Batman.
Like Batman.
Do you think this is Alex Jones' favorite? Because I've heard a little bit about this movie. You think Alex Jones loves this movie?
I don't know. Was it in between him, you know, testing his tap water for fluoride?
Yeah. Or Jesse Ventura does this.
I found out from Captain America that the government is involved in everything we do. I went to the White House to investigate.
Now, I'm assuming, was this all a set or was that green screen in the back?
Isn't that the great thing that it's hard to tell?
Exactly.
I'm assuming they're standing on a platform and then most everything else is green screen,
yeah.
I'm guessing. But it looks good. It's a good looking green screen. There's a couple of parts in the second Thor movie where they're clearly standing behind, you know, all green screen and it's very obvious. That sounds like a great line for the trailer.
Yep.
I don't know if anybody else would agree with this, but I put Chris Evans' performance as Cap right up there with Reeve.
I was about to mention that, because I know that you... And I loved it how it was done, where like they were separate down the middle, and he's going his own way. It's like the little things in visual language of movies, that you can do that without them flat out saying, I don't like you, I'm going this way now, bye.
Now I love... This is one of my favorite scenes in the movie, where he goes to the Smithsonian, and they have a whole Captain America display. I love that they use kind of the lettering and the title from the first movie there. But the best part, the best little add-on.
Oh, God, that's awesome.
Listen to the voice. Do you recognize that voice?
No.
It's Gary Sinise.
Really?
Which is a great, because Gary Sinise in real life is very pro-veteran. He loves the military. He has his own band, and he loves to play... USO shows and all that stuff. So using Gary Sinise as the voice of the Smithsonian Captain America exhibit, I thought
was
just
really
a genius
smart.
Touch. Yeah.
Oh, this is really... Oh, geez, this is...
I know, everyone, I want to visit this exhibit now. They should open an exhibit exactly like this at Disneyland. Because they have, like, the modern Marvels area in Tomorrowland. Like,
oh,
they should have just
there.
Built that
exactly.
in there.
That's what they should do now for Tomorrowland. They should fix it, because I go there all... Oh, God, this is great.
I know, isn't that great? You got all the characters from the first movie, it's...
I have to admit, I am a sucker for this sort of thing, about when you're introducing something, like a new element to the past, right?
Oh,
and you're making it part of the world, and just make it bigger.
Wound right to the heart.
Yeah. Bucky Barnes.
And then the best scene, I think. The best scene in the entire... Marvel Cinematic Movie Universe comes right after this, but we'll get to that.
At this part?
In a sec.
I love this.
No, I haven't seen the Agent Carter miniseries that ABC did, but I really want to see it because it looks
It's not a miniseries, it's a full-on show.
Are they going to do a second season? Mm-hmm. They,
oh, cool. You know what this reminds me of? It's like, because I love going to presidential museums. In particular, it does remind me of going through the JFK one over in Boston. It really does.
I'm surprised that photo in his compass survived through the ice all those years. I think this is the best scene Marvel movies have ever done. I love this scene.
And is that Hayley Atwell?
That's Hayley
makeup.
Which it seems like it might be part makeup, part CG.
It is
because makeup, that's what CG. It seems like. Because there's something. I don't want to say off, but just something a little lips. You can kind of notice. Yeah, there's something about it. But I still love this scene.
Since she's older, they removed some of her facial weight and body weight because when you're that fucking old.
I just want to be quiet now because I want to watch the scene because I love it so much.
Can you imagine being the guy who tries to romance the woman who's Captain America's ex? And the only reason...
Well, to be fair, they didn't really date.
But that's the thing. And the only reason that she's an ex is because he was thought dead. There was no bad breakup. It was just, he's dead.
Yeah.
Can you imagine being that guy? Like, hey, want to go see a movie or something?
Like, I sell insurance. That's what I do. Steady job. Steady work. But no, this is the part. This is so fucking heartbreaking. It's like a punch in the gut. Oh.
Oh God.
Gets me every fucking time. I'm tearing up a little right now just watching it again.
Really?
Oh God.
Jeez. Aww. Okay, that hit.
I don't see that. I think that's the best scene any of the Marvel movies have ever done.
It ended
so fucking good.
Right note. I love that.
Well, you know, David, since you do hate Joss Whedon.
I don't. Who said I hate Joss Whedon? I don't hate Joss Whedon.
You'll be glad to know that the people the two brothers who directed this will be directing the next two Avengers.
I know. I'm happy.
So you can finally stop your boycott of all Joss Whedon movies.
I don't boycott Joss Whedon's movies. I know. That's why what's going on. Oh, my, yes.
Just so everyone out there knows, David was the only person who wrote a letter-writing campaign to cancel Firefly, so...
It worked!
You should flood him with emails.
It works.
Hate emails.
Actually, I have to be honest, I don't particularly care for that show.
Oh!
The show was alright. The movie, I had a headache while watching it.
Really?
Yeah.
The movie is what got me into the TV show, because I hadn't seen the TV show before. I saw the movie in theaters because it looked cool. I was like, this is great. And then I happened to see that it was based on a TV show. I was like, why the fuck haven't I seen this show?
So everyone...
Oh, is it Jenny Gutter?
Yeah.
Yay, Jenny Gutter.
So, and there's the Gotham...
guy from Dark Knight. Yeah, and sweet. The guy from Lost, the Penny's dad.
So, just so we're keeping score, David hates Joss Whedon. I will not see any of his movies. And he actively campaigned to make sure that Firefly would never
wasn't
get
wasn't he in a Law and Order episode?
He's in a lot of shit.
Yeah, he's in a lot of stuff. He's Australian, I think.
Wasn't he the judge who he ended up going after beating up the one guy because he kidnapped his son?
Yep.
And
that's a good episode.
And also, David would rather see any of Joel Schumacher's Batman movies over anything by Joss Whedon.
He
deeply regrets the fact that Joss Whedon has made any movies, but wishes that Joel Schumacher had made more movies and glad that the movies he made exists.
And did we also mention that I laugh during Schindler's List all the time?
And me and Nathan can actually be eyewitnesses of this. He jerks off to Solid.
Now, isn't he the guy that's on All My Salad Dressing?
Isn't he Butch Cassidy?
Isn't he Butch Cassidy? Yeah, he's Butch. Yeah. Didn't he play Butch Cassidy?
You know, he looks pretty good when I last saw him in Road to Perdition. Now, correct me if I'm wrong, but isn't that, Cameron, in the comics, isn't he Red Skull? Like, Red Skull possessed him or something?
Alexander Pierce?
No.
No?
Oh, okay.
Red Skull possessed a former KGB agent.
Okay. Which I have to, this was spoiled for me, and I know that Robert Redford is the bad guy in this movie.
What?
Oh, no, wait, actually, do you know who spoiled it for me?
And you just spoiled it for everyone listening.
Yeah, sorry, guys. But
now, tell me who spoiled it for you.
Robert Redford.
Fuck it.
He gave an interview.
I can't believe.
I remember that. I remember reading that online and being like, oh, you fucking asshole. That's right. I completely forgot about that. That's hilarious.
It reminds me of when they spoiled Batman Begins when they said Liam Neeson is playing Ra's al Ghul. And then it's like, oh, no, he's not.
I like this stuff. Cap listening in on veterans at a kind of a meeting.
Yeah, I'm like, mm-hmm. I like it too.
And nobody notices that Captain fucking America is standing right there.
For some reason, it's just reminding me of the Kevin Smith
story. I know you might have
story.
Post-traumatic stress, but if Captain America all of a sudden shows up, like...
But what if it's like they handled it like Kevin Smith in the Prince thing? So what do you think, Captain America? But no, it's like going back to the museum, right? The Smithsonian, mm-hmm. his own little segment dedicated to Captain America. What I like about it is it makes you feel like you're part of a bigger world.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That is not just exclusively...
Good world building, yeah.
Yeah. And which is, because I'm still on that Star Wars high from the trailer. That is one of those where getting based off it does feel like you're part of a bigger world as opposed to something small.
And that's what I like about it. Even in the Smithsonian scene, you can tell that Steve Rogers, Captain America, is very uncomfortable with the, hero worship. Because he doesn't see himself as anything more than a soldier. Mm-hmm. And... I know some people that we know would disagree with this, but I think so far, of the solo Marvel movies, Captain America's kind of been the king.
Yeah, I really liked the first Captain America when I first saw it. The more I saw it, the more I saw the flaws, and it's not one of my favorites. Well, but I still really enjoy it. But this movie, I'd say Winter Soldier is. Possibly the best, definitely top two, I think, for the entire Marvel series.
Oh,
this movie is fucking great.
I just realized, you know who they didn't have a clip of?
With the exception of the shaky cam.
Who?
They didn't have Tommy Lee Jones.
Maybe. Well, actually, they do show a picture of him later.
Mm-hmm.
You'll see a picture
and
of him
not
later.
Only that, but here comes a great action sequence.
Oh, this is the best action scene in the movie.
And not only this, but it's either in this one or one coming up later... Where I get aren't the people who directed this like the Hill brothers?
They did Community.
No,
they directed stuff for Community.
The last
but
names.
The...
I'm trying to think of their last name, but
I don't remember their names.
The brothers who directed this claim that one of the drivers in one of the cars in one of these movies.
Mm-hmm.
What the hell?
That's Nick Fury being overtaken, and his car's talking to him.
Because it's a shield car.
if I can spot the car, or truck rather, but in one of these action sequences, apparently, rumor is the Punisher is in one of the...
I remember you telling me that, yeah.
Which one was this? The Punisher was where?
The Punisher is in one of these action sequences driving a car. Apparently.
Why?
Because that's what the directors have said.
Because Marvel Universe?
Yeah.
Because they can, apparently, yeah.
And why wouldn't Frank Castle, a former soldier currently fighting his own personal war?
Oh, okay.
I also love that this entire sequence, 90% of it is real.
Mm-hmm.
Like, real cars driving, real crashes, real explosions, all this stuff. And it looks great.
Level of intimacy that is like...
Real eye patch.
Real eye patch.
Real blood, real sweat.
But fake tears.
Fuck yeah!
That's what we've all paid to see.
That's what we want from a movie with Samuel L. Jackson in it. It's him blowing the shit out of people.
Oh, wait a minute. I just remembered. Remember in the Punisher video game? Who was it that he had two players? Who was the second player?
Nick Fury.
shield machine guns. When you absolutely, positively gotta kill every motherfucking trying to kill you, accept no substitutes. Now, I think they filmed most of this in Cleveland, which is where they filmed a lot of Avengers, too. Because Cleveland, I guess, kind of looks like everywhere it can be. It can substitute for basically any city.
That is probably cheaper to film there.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Kind it's fucking like... Cleveland. It's...
Finally, Cleveland can be known for something besides an unfunny Family Guy character.
I guess they didn't want to film in Toronto. Well, that's just... do they film in Toronto just for when it comes to Chicago, right? Or just any city?
Yeah. Any city. Whoever has the better tax breaks, really. That's where you gotta go with. That's one of the big reasons they filmed a lot of Thor in New Mexico. Because at the time, New Mexico had really good filming tax breaks. So they were like, set it in New Mexico! Like, perfect.
And the comics were set in New Mexico at the time.
Really? Mm-hmm. I did not know that.
Cameron's a nerd!
Nerd!
He reads comics.
Hey Nathan, what's your favorite episode of Star Trek?
The one with
the one
guy and the little furry things.
Oh, Trouble with Tribbles?
Yeah.
David's a nerd! I like Sitting on the Edge of Forever.
Now because you're such a nerd, I remember watching the Red Letter Media review of this movie. Mm-hmm. And one of the questions they asked, and I never got an answer to it, was, does Captain America kill people, or does he have, and I quote, a pussy code of ethics like Batman and Superman?
In World War II, he killed people.
Oh yeah, I'm sure he did. But like, in general, is he willing to kill people to get the job done, or is he...
He actively tries to avoid it, but if there's no other way.
Okay.
It's like, let me put it this way. It's not going to be his first option.
Wow.
But that's supposed to be the Punisher.
Beautiful. In the yellow car?
The truck?
Yeah.
The
truck?
Because you're going to... you're going to see why, because that's... The truck pops up.
Uh-oh.
Sweet.
Now, here's the question. How much of this was CGI and how much of it was real?
I think that car really flipped.
You know, actually, that's the best part. That's the best part. That's how you know you're watching, and nowadays, how you're watching really good visual effects, where you can't tell what's real and what's CGI. Mm-hmm. That's good.
His beard is CGI.
The thing that kind of sucks about special effects nowadays is, even if that was a special effect, it seems like it's something they could do in real life, which is why I'm pretty sure it's real. But even when you see something in a movie that's like insanely huge, or you know, giant fucking explosion, or you know, buildings falling out, whatever. Even if they did that for real. Mm-hmm. People will watch it and be like, oh, that's a good CGI.
Yeah.
Like, they'll just brush it off. Like, oh, that's some good special effects and whatnot.
Good point, yeah.
And you know, unless you get the filmmaker saying, like, oh, we really did this really happened, people are still just kind of like, oh, it's good special effects.
Or what you do is you get them to care. If you get the audience to care just like this, then you're good to go.
And here's another Marvel character. That is Agent 13, otherwise known by her real name, Sharon Carter.
Oh,
so is she a daughter or a granddaughter?
Niece.
Niece?
Oh, okay. A grandniece or something.
That's a little better, because if he was attracted to straight-up daughter or granddaughter, maybe a little.
Isn't that what happened in the Captain America film in that was made in, like, what, the 80s or
90s? Yeah, pretty close. And in the comics, it's even creepier, because it's one of those identical niece things where she looks almost exactly like Peggy.
Mm. Oh, God.
Yeah, it's a little creepy.
But I think in the comics, by the time Cap woke up, Peggy was already dead. I think. I'm not 100%.
Kind of like, it's kind of the Austin Powers wrote. Mm-hmm. Isn't that, this is a direct daughter of, you know, his love interest back in the 60s. But when it's Austin Powers, it works, because it's comedy. When it's something like this, you get that little creepy factor.
Well, that's why, you know, it's Emily Van Camp and not Haley Atwell again.
Yeah. apparently she got her revenge and joined S.H.I.E.L.D.
Bum, bum, ba-da.
Did you guys ever watch that show, Revenge?
I know what you're talking about, but you went for a cheap pun.
Which one's Revenge?
It's an ABC show with Emily Van Camp in it. Mm-hmm. I watched the first season, and the first season was pretty darn good. It was pretty addicting. Then I started watching the second season, and it just bored me, so I just stopped watching it. So I don't know whether or not she got her revenge. I love all their code talking in this scene.
They are so gonna fuck.
They are so spies. That's
I'm sorry to have to do this, but I had no place else to crash.
Dun dun dun. Who else has fucked your wife? Oh, I mean...
Tony fucked your wife?
I wouldn't put it past him.
Tony Clifford, you son of a bitch.
Tony Clifford's Iron Man? and
Jackson just gets fucked in this movie.
Yeah, God. He gets fucked up bad. Let's see, car wreck... Fake SWAT teams are after him and all that. Then after all that, he gets a high caliber sniper shot.
But it's all good because he's in the Avengers too.
Captain, I'm Agent 13 of S.H.I.E.L.D. Special Service.
Kate? You lied to me, you bitch.
And Kate is a cover name. Her real name, if she's going to be in Captain America 3, will be Sharon Carter.
Boom! Love it.
That was good.
Captain America teaching Iron Man how to do a number two right.
Oh god! You know, I actually wanted to pick that movie to watch this week
because
it's so fucking terrible, and I had a digital copy of it. Mm-hmm. So I was like, "Oh, we'll just watch my digital copy." And then I went to look at my computer. Apparently, at some point I had said, this movie really fucking sucks. I should just delete it. And I deleted it. So I didn't have a copy to bring to watch. So instead, we're going from the worst Marvel movie, and I decided to choose the best Marvel movie.
That's... God, I remember...
I really wanted to talk about how fucking terrible Iron Man 2 is.
Yeah. We would be arguing over trying to get our points about, no, this is the worst part.
No, this is why it sucks. No, this is why it sucks.
So let's talk about why this is great. And that is one of the main reasons that I actually care about what's going on.
They actually use Scarlett Johansson well.
Yeah, oh my god.
They give her a fucking character in this movie.
Okay, let's really go into, you know, how fucking horribly they use Scarlett Johansson in Iron Man 2. When you see her, it's like, oh, she's hot. Oh, she does all this martial arts stuff. But the thing that pisses me off the most is they have this opportunity to really play Tony as this fucked up, flawed character. Mm-hmm. Who Black Widow could kind of take advantage of as a spy and get the things she needs. Mm. So I totally thought from the trailers, and there's so many scenes where like there's tension built up between them, that Tony was going to end up sleeping with the Black Widow. Mm-hmm. And she was going to get information and kind of just... Because in the comics, I don't think it's done that way. It's not done with, you know, someone seducing Tony to get his secrets. But what happens is S.H.I.E.L.D. buys... more of a Stark Industries stock than Tony owns. So they buy it, stealing his company away from him. Mm. And I thought something like that was going to happen, except Black Widow was going to be the one to kind of have a part in it.
You know what happens instead?
Nothing.
Nothing happens.
There's this influence.
Sam Rockwell does a little dance. And Mickey Rourke asks about his bird.
Don't even get me started on how much Sam Rockwell was missing.
You know, you can see Sam Rockwell dance in a better movie. It's called Confessions of a Dangerous Mind.
There's a scene between them where Tony's like, hey, if you knew you were going to die tomorrow, this is going to be your last birthday, what would you do? And she's saying that to Black Widow. And they're in his bedroom. the lighting, the music.
Oh.
You're thinking like, oh man, is he gonna fuck up? I mean, is he gonna
time for booty sex? If anything,
is he gonna break Pepper's heart or anything? And no, nothing fucking happens. She says
instead he gets drunk and wears his Iron Man suit and dances to a DJ.
And then another action sequence happens just because we have to have an action sequence. Because see, the thing is, when it comes to action sequences, what works about them? Is it the explosions, the visual effects? It's what ultimately comes down to it's the characters. It's the drama. And that is, if you care about the characters, you care about where the story's going.
There's no drama in Iron Man 2.
Yeah. Or if there is any attempt.
Bullshit.
Oh, the worst part was is that they blew their load in the first, 20 minutes of the film when Whiplash shows up.
And that's another horrible thing. It's like they want to build up Whiplash to be this amazing villain, and Stark beats him with Game Boy armor.
Yeah.
and not only that, but they try to build this whole thing of, oh, Stark's going to die. Tony Stark's going to die. And what happens?
Oh, yeah. He's poisoning. He's slowly going to die. And then...
Yeah, here's how often that shit's referenced. Once... He collapses and needs help up. Then they forget it until towards the end of the movie, where Scarlett Johansson's like, "Here, magic shot."
Gives him an injection. It's like, okay, that should last you for a while. It's like, what the fuck? Ugh, it's so stupid.
Oh, I love this. Where now it's like, once again, if you're looking at this, he's alone in the middle by himself. Everybody is walking away from him. Who can he trust? Is there anyone he could trust?
The vending machine.
Yeah, no fucking shit. Maybe he wants some M&M's.
Captain Vending Machine.
Now, isn't his character from the comics, too?
Yes, his character, I can't remember what his real name is, going by his real name in this, but in the comics, that character's known as Crossbones.
That's right.
I thought his name was Agent I'm a Bad Guy.
Who's a mercenary who works under the employee of the Red Skull in the comics.
Ooh, bitch.
Sassy.
Shut down.
Woo! You know, it's really good to see Willem Dafoe get more roles.
Wait, where's Willem Dafoe? Oh. I was like, I've seen this movie a bunch. And Willem, oh, you mean Robert Redford.
Yeah, time has
God, Iron right. Man 2 is horrible.
So
no,
bad.
But this is good. This is good.
This is good. This is great. This is the exact opposite of Iron Man 2.
You want to know a movie gets too much flack, but it's better?
What?
Iron Man 3. Now I'm not saying Iron Man 3 is not better.
Wait. Iron Man 3 gets flack?
Yeah, a lot of people, because they're angry.
I thought it was considered one of the better ones.
Yeah, people are angry because of the Mandarin reveal.
It was one of the most profitable ones.
The Mandarin thing? That's one of the best parts of the movie.
I like the reveal. And let me put it this way. I like the reveal. It entertained me. I think Iron Man 3 is the sequel that Iron Man 2 wanted to be. Would I have been happier if the actual Mandarin was in the movie? I can't say that I wouldn't.
I mean, it was definitely something that threw me, and I wasn't expecting it, but I was like, oh, okay, I get what they're going for.
But still, Marvel's already revealed that there is a real Mandarin out there.
Yeah, there's the short film.
Yeah, so there
they did with him in jail, which is great.
Yeah.
I think it's on, is it with Guardians of the Galaxy or Thor 2 or something?
No, I think it's Thor 2.
Yeah, that's a great short film.
There is a real Mandarin out there.
Yeah, I remember seeing Iron Man 3 and being disappointed. In a way that, you know, if they had called the movie Tony Stark PI, I'd be like, okay, I know exactly what movie I'm going to see. But because they called Iron Man 3, I expected a lot more Iron Man and a lot more action kind of stuff. And it wasn't that, and it was fine, but I was, like, kind of disappointed. But then later that same summer, I saw Man of Steel, and I was like, oh, Iron Man 3 is fucking Citizen Kane.
Yeah, if you had brought in Iron Man 2, I would have brought in Man of Steel.
I got no problem watching Man of Steel, doing a commentary for it. Talk about that movie forever.
There would just be you and me back and forth going, it's awesome, it sucks, it's awesome, it
pretty
sucks.
Much.
And you're going to have me laughing my ass off at the action sequences. Did the doggy whine?
No, he yawned.
Aww, so cute. And now he's biting his ass. So.
Just like Iron Man 2.
Oh, that fucking movie.
Oh.
Because I loved you in The Sting.
I loved you in Snowpiercer.
The best buddies. And nobody says, I loved you in London. Have you seen that movie? That movie's awful.
What? London?
Yeah, the Chris Evans.
Oh, the movie with Jessica Biel in it, too.
What, did you think I was referring to London?
No, I was trying to think, is there a movie? Is there a movie named London?
No, London, the one where he's doing drugs.
What, London After Midnight?
I'd love to see that remade, actually.
I would just like it if they could find the original
print. Yeah,
I'm willing to bet it's out there. It has to be.
But to everybody out there in Hollywood, if you want to remake something, remake a film that's lost. So that nobody's going to be able to compare it. Well, that's not true. And I don't think you do
either. I like his outfit in this one. Mine, mm-hmm. Doesn't have any red in it. Doesn't make it very American, but looks good. I like it.
Can I put how happy I am that Robert Redford is in this movie? That it does add this gravitas to it.
I remember. Did you see that last movie he was in where he's at sea?
Almost Lost.
That Gilligan's Island.
That movie.
Gilligan's Island. He plays the professor in the Gilligan's Island remake.
Actually, I would like to see that, but no. Almost Lost is great.
With Jim Carrey as Gilligan. Yeah.
I liked it, but it wasn't as good as I thought it was going to be. Because everyone's,
doesn't he only say
praising it, and then I watch it, and I was like, okay, it was fine.
He only says one thing, right? Does he only say fuck?
He only has a couple lines in it.
And Cap suspects something. Are the walls closing in on our Star-Spangled Crusader? Tune in next time. Same Cap time. Same Cap channel.
But yeah, I remember watching All Is Lost because I remember everyone was saying about he deserved to get an Oscar nomination and all these awards and blah, blah, blah. And then I finally saw the movie and I was like, yeah, I'm not surprised he wasn't nominated. He was good, but he wasn't great.
This sequence is awesome. Everything from the beginning to the build-up. This is awesome.
This is one of the best scenes in the movie, too.
Again, this is another thing that I also really enjoyed in the first Captain America movie. They give you small glimpses as to how good of a thinker and tactician Captain America really is.
That's the one thing that really disappointed me in the first movie is they kind of, before he gets, the serum and whatnot, they kind of show that he doesn't really need brawn because he has brains and stuff like that. But then the end of the movie is basically just him
beating the
throwing fists with Red Skull. And it's like, you need to throw in that little bit of, now he has the brain, has the brawn and the brains. Have him use both. Instead, he just uses his brawn.
I'm gonna say this when it comes to Captain America. He's a better audience surgate than Tony.
Than
Iron Man, yeah.
That's good, because he's a little bit of fish out of water in a way.
Even in the movies, I know people, fall.
Also, because Tony's over the top.
Even in the movies where he's over the top and lovable.
Over the tarp?
Over the tarp.
It's
over
a tarp!
Over the top and lovable. Tony Stark's still the biggest asshole in Marvel. Yeah.
That's why I love in the Avengers movies when they put them both together. You get scenes with Chris Evans and Robert Downey Jr. playing off each other. It's great.
Okay, I love that.
But no, this is so badass. Oh.
No.
Oh, it's awesome. Kneecaps. Oh, face.
Jeez.
Love this shit.
It's like this guy took on battalions of Nazis. You think you fuckers have a shot?
That's great.
Oh, Jesus, this is good.
I love this part, too. Look at his face. Look how red he gets.
Yeah.
It's like, oh.
But it's also the fact that he's given, a problem. He has to fix it. He's this handicap. Yep. And he's... And they save the big guy for last. But what I also like is that you can tell that he doesn't really want to do this, right? Because these are supposed to be his buddies, right?
They're soldiers.
Yeah.
Boing.
God.
Love that.
And people can say the original Iron Man's the best Marvel movie all they want, and it is a great movie. Don't get me wrong, I love the first Iron Man.
So good.
But this is
seriously,
better.
Winter Soldier, Captain America, makes Iron Man his bitch.
I'm going to go even further. This is, right now, from what I've seen so far, this is actually the best Marvel film I've seen. In terms of the Disney Marvel, starting with Iron Man and going up to Avengers 2.
And that's why this movie and, you know, actually, for me, all the Captain America movies show, from First Avenger to, you know, Avengers to this to Age of Ultron, show why, when Civil War happens in the movies, I'm going to be on Captain America's side.
Yeah, for me, the best Marvel movie is, I want to say it's this one, but then every time I watch Guardians of the Galaxy, I'm like, it's fucking Guardians of the Galaxy. Like, for me, this one and Guardians are really close.
Yeah.
It's hard for me to choose whenever I watch this movie, I'm like, oh, this is the best Marvel movie. And then every time I watch Guardians, I'm like, oh, this is the best Marvel movie.
I think I know the reason what works so well about those movies.
Captain America doing something very Captain America. Oh, shit. Fuck.
Give me my shield. I love it. The way they end the sequence too, the last shot of this sequence is fucking beautiful.
Wow.
And bam! Love it. I wish they would have held on that shot a little more. It was great.
Wasn't that shot in the trailer? Because if not, that's the best way.
That's the money shot that you do before it goes black
and you go, Captain America. Yeah.
The one reason I might put this one a little over Guardians, even though I hate the fucking shaky, the one thing that I truly dislike about this movie is the shaky cam during the action scenes. The thing that gets me about Guardians, why I might not like it quite as much as this movie, is the plot. When you boil it down to it,
a little too basic.
Guardians has the exact same plot as Captain America: The First Avenger, The Avengers, and Thor 2. Like, all four of those movies have basically the same plot of, there's an Infinity Stone, a bad guy wants to get it, then use it to take over the world, and the hero has to stop him.
See, that's why, what I like about that last sequence is the one person who questioned why they should go after Cap is the, you know, probably from the comics, his biggest love interest.
Mm. Yeah.
This is a great reveal right here. It's,
man,
beautiful.
People really wanted that bubble.
Perfect, yeah.
And I love how she's chewing.
It's because then you know instantly. You don't need to be told anything. It's like, oh, I get exactly what happened. Where did you get it? Why would I tell you? Here, he gave it to you. Why are we going to keep asking questions?
But you know what? You know what? I would put this above Guardians of the Galaxy, even though I loved it. Winter Soldier actually has a great villain. Lee Pace, that's his name, right? He was fine as Ronin, but Ronin was a shitty villain because he was just so
he's very kind of a basic run of the mill kind of villain.
Yeah.
But I would argue Guardians of the Galaxy kind of needs that kind of villain because everything else in the movie is so weird.
Yeah.
And over the top, that you kind of need something to kind of balance it out.
It's not even just him that you can be a basic villain, but have some character put into it. And he was just like, "I want to destroy things."
But then,
why? Because I want to destroy things. Why? Because even the Empire in Star Wars, they're as bad guys as you can get. Like, we're bad and we do evil things. But in the first one, you understand why they're blowing up Alderaan. They're doing it to prove a point. Don't fuck with us, because this will happen to your planet. But it was like, I want the stone for reasons!
But then it's like, it's over the top of the city, but then at the end, how does he get defeated? A dance-off.
Dance-off.
But just his reaction is like, what are you doing?
I love it when he says it the first time. He's just like, what are you doing? He's like, it just cracks me up.
I just think that villain would have been a lot better served if we'd actually seen him do stuff. Is it like before the end?
Mm.
Like, we only get to see him do stuff like when he kind of makes Drax his bitch, when they want to go one on one. Like, oh, I do remember your family. And that's not even at the end of the movie. That's like right before they go to the climax. Like, if anything, Nebula, the chick played by Karen Gillan, she's more of a dynamic villain.
Well, why do you think they kept her? This council moves to immediately reactivate Project Insight.
You want to say something snappy? Now would be a good time. Someone get me Joss Whedon to write a line for me.
Hail Hydra? Hail Hydra?
That'll be snappy.
I love you.
Love those glasses.
Yep.
He looks like...
I bet he has an S underneath that shirt.
Yeah. He looks like what Hollywood thinks a hacker looks like. Like, that's...
You know the funny...
It's like, we need...
Holy shit, he's Clark Kent.
Yeah, he could have been Superman. Yeah. But you know what would happen, though, Cameron?
What?
Everybody would have bitched about his hair. Superman's supposed to have dark black hair.
Well, they would have dyed his hair.
They would have dyed his hair.
Even then, they don't even have to dye his hair. Because is Superman really Superman if he has different color hair?
He basically is Superman. Chris Evans' Captain America is essentially... I would argue that this is... movie, Captain America 2, is a better Superman movie than the last four or five Superman movies.
You want to do combined. This right now?
I do.
You want to do this?
I do.
Uh-oh. Shit's gonna go down, son!
So, David, I want to ask you. If you're making a Superman movie, and you did cast Chris Evans in this, there's no Captain America thing, would you ask him to dye his hair black or go, no, stay blonde?
For Superman?
Yeah.
Is he naturally blonde?
The thing is, I would just want to cast
the
right...
I think he's kind of natural. No, I'm not. I'm not asking, you know... Let's just say you have Chris Evans. That's your guy as Superman. Uh-huh. You have determined that he's the right person for the role. Do you have him dye his hair black to get the look complete? Or do you go, nah, you don't have to dye your hair black?
It doesn't matter to me.
I would go to dye his hair black.
It wouldn't matter, because it'd be one of those where if he's right for the role, it doesn't matter if his hair is that color.
But
if he was a redhead,
that's the thing. This isn't a discussion about him being a right for the role, because you already hired him.
Well, the thing is that it wouldn't matter to me.
With Scarlett Johansson. Her hair color is not naturally red.
Oh, my God. I was just thinking.
I think she's like...
She's blonde, I think.
Yeah. No, I think it's just like brown. But she
made a brunette.
I don't know why. It just reminds me of, like, I keep his hair that way. It would be like, you know, that scene in Ed Wood. We'd be like, oh, you know, he's bald. Oh, you're right. Put a wig on him. That's what it's going to be like for me with Superman.
And also with Superman, it's a much tougher position to be in. Because he's a character without a mask.
True.
With Batman, you could believably have a blonde Batman.
I wouldn't want Chris Evans to be wearing a mask. Mm-mm. No, sir.
There's too much clothes on him already.
There are too many clothes on both the leads in this movie, okay?
Take the clothes off!
And I would say that's a problem with Avengers as well. Evans has too many clothes.
That was a good line.
Chris Hemsworth has too much clothes.
Yeah.
Ugh.
Elizabeth Olsen has too much clothes. Aaron Johnson has too much clothes. Thankfully, Mark Ruffalo has the right amount of clothes on some of the time.
Why was he the only one in the first Avengers movie to not have any clothes? You look at the entire cast of Avengers, it's like, who should we get down to their skivvies? Mark Ruffalo.
Hey, at least we have the first Captain America to get some Chris Evans down to his skivvies.
Now that to me is the single line that defines Steve Rogers.
Yeah.
Like, we're barring it, get your feet off the dash. Like, it's perfect.
And I forgot. I was about to say something from Age of Ultron, but David's here, so
I already know what happens. Quicksilver dies. Ultron dies.
Whoa! Spoiler alert.
The Hulk
for
goes.
Listening.
The Hulk, okay, so Hulk goes missing.
How do you know all this stuff? Did you just read a synopsis online?
Some jerk spoiled it for me.
It's, okay. It's not only that, but if I wasn't gonna spoil anything,
so I'm the jerk who spoiled it to you guys.
Yeah.
Wait,
can I take a guess as to who spoiled it for you? Now, let me take a guess.
No. He didn't. He wouldn't do... I don't know if he wouldn't do that, but he didn't do that for Age of Ultron.
Who did?
Some random forum I went to, like...
Oh, never mind, so I don't know the person.
It was like...
Was it that prequel apologist?
Oh, no. No, it wasn't. No. That guy's a jerk anyway, so... So strange. He hates everything else. He loves the prequels, though. He's one of those people where he's like...
So basically, he's a nerd hipster.
Oh, no, this is the worst part, where he goes, if anybody goes up to me and tells me that Tim Burton's made a good movie, you can just shut up
there. Wait, did he say a good movie period or a good movie since this point?
No, a good movie.
Good movie period.
Hold on. Edward Scissorhands, Batman, Frank and Weenie, both versions I think are good. That's probably the most recent Burton movie I like.
Yeah,
Edwards. Did I ever say Edward Scissorhands?
Yeah, you did. But basically, it's one of those...
Beetlejuice.
Yeah, but it's one of those things that is like the, I'm better than you because of this. And I'm thinking to myself, I don't give a damn.
So he's an online nerd hipster.
I would say that for the most part, and it's hard for me to remember where it all... No, it did begin. The only... I love this part.
I love these little flashbacks that he has.
But I mean, it's just I just don't like this.
This can be considered hipster if some people want to, but the only Burton Depp collaboration I can watch anymore is Edward Scissorhands.
What about Ed Wood?
Oh yeah, I forgot about Ed
Wood. What about Sleepy Hollow?
Oh yeah, I forgot he did Sleepy Hollow, because here's the thing, and this
I'm not
is,
a Sleepy Hollow fan, I gotta admit.
See, here's the thing, and this is probably, you know, on my part, when I think of Sleepy Hollow, I don't think Tim Burton, because I enjoy it.
But anyways,
it is weird.
But basically what happened was, yeah, it was spoiled. But what happened to Avengers you were talking about?
Since you already spoiled it,
was it just a joke?
Yeah, I'm gonna say this, so if you don't want to listen, I'm gonna say, spoilers for a running joke in the movie.
Oh, no, don't spoil that for David. Because we got to let him get some enjoyment.
Is the running joke Quicksilver?
No.
Actually, nice. He actually does have a little running, not really a running joke, but he has a
good rule of three joke with Hawkeye.
Yeah, yeah. But no, don't spoil that joke for David. He needs something to look forward to.
But
he already knows the plot of the movie.
That line kind of sums up Cap, too. That running
joke. Oh, yeah, yeah. There's Tommy Lee. There he is.
Yep.
That grizzled slab of stone of a face.
Did Tommy Lee get paid for this?
I'm sure he got a likeness. Because they're using his likeness.
The guy who plays Howard Stark in both Captain America, the first one, that picture, and Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. is now going to be playing Jesse Custer on the upcoming Preacher show.
Oh, really?
Mm-hmm. And if you haven't read Preacher, Nathan, you should.
Okay.
You should.
Actually, you know, one of the reasons why I do like the especially this one and also the first Captain America film is I liked the casting involved in it. It's like, let's cast Tommy Lee Jones. Let's cast Toby Jones and Hugo Weaving and Stanley Tucci.
Oh, Stanley Tucci's great in the first one.
And that's why I'm a big fan of the first Captain America, just because that scene with Tucci and Evans and the barracks.
The reason I'm such a big fan of the original Captain America is because it had been so long, and I'm saying this as someone who loves Batman and considers Batman Begins to be my favorite Batman movie of all time, if not my favorite movie of all time, period. But it was just so comforting to finally see a movie where there's no dead parents, there's no "I will get vengeance" moment. It's all this guy going. The great line, "I don't want to kill anybody, I just don't like bullies." It's pretty much the whole thing of, why do I want to do this? Because it's the right thing to do.
Mm-hmm. Wait a minute.
Man of Steel also has Nathan.
Wait a minute. Isn't who I think is going to show up in this? I heard that Toby Jones comes back in this movie.
What?
I don't know. Hey, Danny DeVito shows up.
This is another, I think, one of the best scenes in the movie.
You know what my favorite part of Avengers was when Batman betrayed Gryffindor and joined the Avengers to save the world from Doctor Doom.
Shall we play a game?
You could just
wait for it.
Shall we play a game? Okay, nice call, all right.
Nice call, David.
I know, I saw it.
Oh,
David, you know what would be a great edit to put on this?
Why?
Instead of this face popping up, Holly. Huh. From Red Dwarf. What's happening, dudes? Oh, God. I love the backstory bits we got on Black Widow at Avengers Age of Ultron, too.
Oh, yeah.
That's Toby Jones.
Yep.
Yeah. Arnim Zola. He said, "But David." He said, "But."
Yep. That's really cool.
I love just like the giant room of tape. Computer tape is great.
He is so much better suited to be Captain America than he was Human Torch.
Oh hell yeah!
And speaking of Human Torch, fuck the Fantastic Four movie coming out.
Okay.
Oh man,
that's it. I'm sold. This is awesome. I love this.
Oh, did you hear the bullshit that they're trying to, the latest bullshit in the Fantastic Four movie?
I don't know, I'm just really intrigued by Toby Jones on the computer right now.
Definitely, as soon as we're done doing comedy, just watch this movie again immediately without us talking over the entire thing.
You need to, I think it's so on Netflix now, so you can watch it on Netflix.
Is it?
Yeah.
Is it?
Oh. Captain America?
Yes.
Awesome.
I'm pretty sure. But, Nathan, if I were to ask you, hey, what's Mr. Fantastic's power?
Oh, I read about this.
What would you say his power is?
he can stretch his body.
But not in the new
like
movie.
Yeah,
because it got to be all specifically scientific.
It's very scientific.
He alters space-time around him to get something, get something. And to our puny human eyes, it looks like stretching.
I remember reading that and thinking, like, isn't that the same fucking thing?
Yeah,
like,
but why do you... they're trying to be so... Yeah. And I hate these fucking buzzwords in movies. Real and grounded.
That's the thing. I don't remember if I mentioned it in earlier commentary, but I mentioned it to you. There was a... When they released the first teaser trailer, and then they had, like, a little interview with the director, I think the producer, screenwriter, whoever, and he was saying, like, yeah, I really wanted to make, you know, the film... more grounded and realistic and gritty. And I remember thinking, those are words that should absolutely never be associated with the Fantastic Four, ever.
I am hesitant to link them to things like Batman, even. You want to know why? Batman fights a clown who dresses up in old-style Vegas comedian clothing and kills people with things that range from giant jack-in-the-boxes to plain knives. Now, what makes that grounded and realistic is how you react to it. It's like Star Wars. Star Wars is the original good movies. They're as far out there as you can get. Han Solo's best friend is a giant dog that's a sharpshooter. But you want to know what makes it... But you want to know what makes it work? Han Solo's a normal guy. Yeah, he's the pilot of a spaceship. He's a smuggler. But hey, he wants a girl that's a little bit above his pay grade... He's a skeptic when it comes to, you know, the Force. And his best friend's his dog. So, David, did you get all that from about Hydra and S.H.I.E.L.D.?
Yeah, and I'm loving it. I'm a sucker for this.
No, I was just kind of worried that you couldn't hear it over us talking about it.
This is why it's helpful to see this movie before seeing the new Avengers, because... You're like, it's not something that's necessary, but it definitely helps.
Well, I think in one aspect it's necessary, because, spoilers, if you're watching Age of Ultron, you're going to be wondering where's S.H.I.E.L.D.
Yeah, that's the thing. Like, it opens up with, I mean, I won't spoil anything, but it opens up with something, and then you immediately think, wait, why are they doing this? Oh, whatever. Just go with it. It's kind of like, as I was telling David earlier, it helps to watch Thor before watching the first Avengers. And same thing with this. It helps to see this movie before seeing the new Avengers.
So here's my question then. When it comes to... Because I want to do this. Like, have, like, an entire film collection of, like, the Marvel stuff, for the most part. What are the ones...
That are completely
that
necessary?
Are required, I think.
Okay, personally... You're talking about...
You mean quality or...
No, that are required.
Well, quality and required.
If you want me to be 100% honest, the only movie I can think of offhand that you... don't need to see.
Iron Man 2?
Yes. Okay. And here's why. People can say, oh, but you got to watch it because that's where they introduced Black Widow.
But they
bullshit.
Do that in the Avengers.
They do a far
superior job.
And wait a minute. Yeah. I just defended that scene. Does that mean I'm still the Joss Whedon hater?
Oh, yeah. You hate Joss Whedon.
I could argue you don't need to see... I think Incredible Hulk either, even though it's a good movie and I like it a lot.
I don't think you have to see it. The post-credit scene.
You don't really need that.
Not really.
But you definitely need to watch the first Captain America, because it sets everything.
First Captain America, first Thor, first Iron Man.
And then
Avengers.
Then
Cap 2, Thor 2. You don't really need to see Iron Man 3.
Do you need to see Thor 2?
As good of a movie as it is.
I think you need to see Thor 2. I think you do, just to set up. Because Thor 2 actually, Iron Man 3 doesn't have an Infinity Gem in it.
Oh, that's true. Yeah, that's right.
Guardians of the Galaxy, I think, is must-see just because it's Guardians of the Galaxy.
Because Thanos plays I don't want to say a big role, but a bigger role than
he's the
he
Emperor.
Before. Yeah.
Speaking of the Emperor, and I'm not talking Winter Soldier. God damn, look how wrinkly he is. Oh, shit.
Now, do you think that's wrinkles, or do you think you got a force lightning blast to the face, since that's the only way you can look
and
fucking
there we go,
old.
Ladies and gentlemen.
Right, Unky George? Right, Unky George? But you want to know what the perfect tone for a Fantastic Four movie is? Doctor Who meets 60s Star Trek.
Oh, yeah. I can see that.
Because it's fun, adventure... a family.
You know what a perfect Fantastic Four movie is?
The Incredibles.
Yeah, that's exactly the kind of tone you need.
And there we go.
That would be like Fantastic
That's
Four.
How much of a dick which, Robert Redford is.
Which the first two Fantastic Four movies
they got the,
kind of had they, tone.
They come close, but this
but
is...
But the scripts are so fucking shitty.
This is the thing that blows me away about every... Now, I say this, but only the ones I've seen. I'd love to see the Roger Corman version one day. But,
I've seen bits and pieces of it.
It's hilarious.
But from what I have seen, but the movies I have seen, the one thing that consistently gets fucked up in the Fantastic Four movies is Doctor Doom. Because they always think they need to change what's already perfect. It's one of those things where you don't get much more perfect than a foreign dictator who's both a scientist and sorcerer supreme. I don't mean official sorcerer
supreme.
Wait,
Chris Evans has a shirt off. Be quiet.
Oh. Oh, she's got a tank top on. I don't know I don't know what chest to look at.
Nothing. What's going on with you?
Nothing. I'm sorry. I was just staring at your chest. That would... I would love it if that was an outtake of the movie. Where Scarlett Johansson's like, I'm sorry. I'm just staring at your chest.
I like your chest.
And then he goes, so was I.
It's like, oh, what? So sexy. Yeah.
I guess I can't tell the difference anymore.
There's a chance you... And what I also really like about this movie is they kind of play around with flirtation, but it never feels romantic between them.
Yeah.
They're, it's more like, you know, again, it's a purely friendship kind of thing, which I really like. They try to steer away from the romance thing because they're sticking with the idea that Cap already had a love, and he lost her.
Would you trust me to do it?
I would now.
See, even in these sit-down scenes, why is the camera shaking? Put that shit on a tripod and let me watch the characters interact without...
I think it's just because you're supposed to be kept on... I think the reason why, for me, at least, it's like you're kept on edge where it feels like at any moment somebody's going to burst in and start attacking
them. Another reason I love The Winter Soldier is it introduced one of my favorite characters, the Falcon. I fucking love the Falcon.
Is he going to punch him or give him a kick?
We aren't talking about stupid F-Zero Captain Falcon.
It would be pretty cool if he went. If he did go, Falcon Punch. So the real question. And then that's when. And then that's when he's like, Falcon, show me your moves.
God, I love. I'm sorry, but like, and plus, even Falcon's ripped. I want to see him without a shirt on.
He is. He's been in a lot of movies where he's been ripped. Yeah. Is
go watch Pain and Gain.
Pain and Gain. I was just thinking of that. Yeah. I mean, don't get me wrong. Don't watch Pain and Gain. But he's in it, and he's very ripped.
Because you'll experience a lot of pain, and you'll gain nothing.
I really want to see a Falcon solo as well. Like if they give the Falcon a Netflix show, I'd watch the shit out of that.
Doesn't he in the comics eventually become the new Captain America?
Yeah. In the comics. Long story short, Cap gets the super soldier serum taken out of his body and he ages rapidly so he can no longer be Captain America. So
I thought he just croaked. Just got
so
shot.
He, no, that happened when Bucky took over. Captain America was assassinated because essentially Tony Stark fucked up and Captain America got assassinated for it.
Wasn't there like a big controversy over the fact that Falcon replaced him?
Well, I think it is because... the way it was reported by outlets was Cap becomes a black guy, which makes it sound like Captain America goes to sleep white, wakes up black, instead of Captain America's longtime best friend and partner, the Falcon, takes over for him in his time of need.
Yeah. Here's another fixed mistake from Iron Man 2.
Yeah, they actually use Gary Shandling properly.
And I was happy that when he showed up in this movie, I was like, oh my god, he's in the movie.
And there
like,
we go. But there's your meme. There's
and,
your meme.
And I have I've read the comics where Falcon has become Captain America, and they're great.
Also, Gary Shandling has like the worst plastic surgery done on his face.
But we want to know somebody else who. Let's see, Gary Shandling was done wrong in Iron Man 2. Scarlett Johansson was done horribly wrong by Iron Man 2. And Sam Rockwell was. You want to know why? You want to know what he should have played? He should have played a guy who was both smarter than Tony Stark and way more ruthless than he ever was. Huh. Instead of just a second banana to Tony Stark. Yeah. Because that's how you make your villains. You make your villains stronger than your heroes. That's why Lex Luthor works for Superman, because Superman's got the powers. He's got the trustworthiness and all that, but Superman's not dumb, but Lex Luthor's a genius beyond compare. And that's how he can fuck with him.
You wouldn't hit a guy with glasses, would you?
I love that scene. Oh, God, I love that in Batman.
Or the part previous set when he's like he kicks the fake teeth out of his mouth.
Seriously though, in the comics, Justin Hammer was a guy that Tony.
He was an old man, wasn't he?
He was the old man, and he is essentially the evil Tony Stark.
Did they just kill him?
No. Oh, Falcon! Falcon!
Okay, that was a good review. I like that.
You don't care if this is spoiled for you either, David.
Is he in the movie?
Did they finish? Oh, he shows. There, you know the party sequence they show in the trailer.
He has a cameo. Yeah.
He shows up in the party. Then they kind of talk about what happened in this movie, and then you do eventually see him in costume in the movie. I'm not going to tell you what the circumstances are, but they give him his red tints and his uniforms, where he even looks more like Falcon from the comics.
Really?
I don't care. I don't care if I'm sounding like I'm fanboying out. Fucking love the Falcon.
He just peed himself.
I fucking love the Falcon. The 21st century. I like him way better as.
Oh, that's a good line. That's a good line.
Yeah, I love how they bring this idea of the government knows all of your bank records, your phone records, everything about you. Oh, it's just a fantasy Marvel movie. It's not.
It's not.
It's not. It's like, oh, hitting on real life
however,
right now.
However, the fantasy aspect of it is them using everything you know to predict what you're going to do. Mm-hmm. I do like one of the names, I don't know if that either has been mentioned or you see it eventually, is Dr. Stephen Strange.
Yeah, he mentioned his name earlier.
Awesome.
Yeah.
What the?
But as far as cat partners go, I've also always preferred Falcon to Bucky. For me, Bucky only got interesting in the actual Winter Soldier storyline in the comics by Ed Brubaker and, I can't, I'm blanking on the artist's name right now. I don't think it's Lee Weeks, but that was the only time Bucky ever became interesting.
Goodbye, boom.
Of course, up until the Winter Soldier storyline, Bucky was considered a teen sidekick in the vein of Robin, which is what he was created as.
Yeah.
Makes
sense.
Well, essentially, every teen sidekick after Robin is essentially, especially in that time period, a ripoff of Robin.
Mm-hmm.
And with Captain America, it was really weird because he's taking a teenage boy into World War II. That's what's fucked up about it. I mean, yeah, taking a young boy to fight mobsters and gangsters is one thing, but the way the comics eventually explained it was Dick Grayson was sneaking out of Wayne Manor to do that on his own. So Bruce had the choice.
Now, this scene, that would scare the fucking hell out of me.
It would, too.
Like, if you're in a car chase and your car's kind of uncontrollable, at least you have your wheel to kind of try and do something. Yeah, but if someone rips your wheel out of your car, like, what the fuck are you supposed to do?
Look at
Oh, he's so cute.
He's sleeping.
He's sleeping.
Now we woke him up.
Now we woke him up.
But in the comics, they explain Batman taking on a Robin to keep Robin from essentially going out and getting himself killed.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
In the comics, way Ed Brubaker explained it was, Bucky was never 13. He was like 18 years old. He looked extremely young for his age. So they used his youth as kind of propaganda.
Mm-hmm.
Like, hey, kids, help. Help your parents, you know, get the scrap metal for the cause and all that. But what he really was kind of a black ops kind of guy who would sneak in anywhere Cap and his team. And his World War II team called the Invaders, which was him, the original Golden Age Human Torch, and Namor. Whenever the Invaders would be in, Bucky would go out first, stake out the area, and if necessary, kill people kind of silently. Bucky was kind of like Black Widow.
Do you think we'll ever see Namor in any of these Marvel films?
Who?
Namor.
I don't think we'll ever see. I don't think we'll ever see him solo unless they work at a.
If they completely run out of characters to make movies about.
I think we. Let me put it this way. If Marvel... No, I'm not going to say if. When Marvel gets the Fantastic Four back, you'll see Namor. Not that he's tied with them particularly, but because Namor's a wife-stealing bastard who tries to steal... he tries to break up Reed and Sue.
So he broke up Flipper's marriage?
Yeah, he's a dolphin fucker. But he's also an Avenger. He's also... He's one of those people that's both a villain and a hero, depending
did
on how
he really feels. Free Willy, if you know what I mean?
Yeah, he fucked an orca. I actually do think he did fuck an Atlantean named Orca. But you'd see him probably in an Avengers movie if Marvel really wanted Namor before then. But unless you introduce Namor now, you can't really have him be linked with Steve Rogers, because that's the only way that they've ever been able to get him in the Avengers in the comics, by is how much he respects Steve Rogers. Because he hates the Avengers otherwise.
Jesus.
Oh, Falcon.
Whee!
Falcon!
He's a motherfucker.
See, I really hope that Civil War, the Captain America Civil War, is
Mr.
just
Falcon.
Again, 2 hours of Captain America, the Falcon, and Black Widow just beating the shit out of everybody.
You mean beating up Tony?
If they make Civil War as close as they can to the comics, people will hate Tony Stark.
Well, they should.
Well, yeah, Tony Stark is the biggest asshole.
Maybe that's what's happening. I've got a conspiracy right now. A little right now.
A conspiracy theory.
The reason why Robert Downey Jr. is acting like such a dick as of late.
Wait, how's he acting like a dick?
The whole the interview thing, no, the Hispanic. No, I saw that when it came to the interview. I think that was bullshit because that guy who does the interviews, he does like political news interviews and such, and he okayed it with Robert Downey Jr.'s team. It's okay if he asks these questions. Well, so either two things happened. One, Robert Downey Jr. knew that what those questions were going to be asked and decided to be a dick about it. Or two, Downey Jr.'s PR team totally screwed the pooch.
I think they screwed the pooch. I don't think he knew. And in all honesty, even if you are... Let me put it this way. If you're Barbara Walters and you're doing an interview with somebody on the Avengers and you go, hey, remember when you got so coked out you broke into somebody's house and got in their kid's bed? Remember that?
Well, but that's the thing, though, is that he...
I'm sorry, that guy's a dickhead. Like, I've seen him go try to barb words with people who aren't having it.
Well, like who? Tarantino?
Like Tarantino.
Oh, no.
I love that interview. I love Tarantino serving that motherfucker.
But he's such an immature little shit.
I have to watch that.
No, I side with Tarantino on that, and I side with Downey on that. Fuck that guy. What do you think violence does to kids? It's not my fucking problem, dude. I've answered that question.
But here's the thing, though. That when he's asking the questions, he's not saying, oh, I disagree with you. He's one of those interviewers who gets people engaged.
And if he doesn't want to answer the question, then fine. Fuck that guy. Because Tarantino kept saying, I'm not going to answer that question. But I want you to answer the question. I want you. Fuck you. I'm not answering the question. But I want you to answer the question. Motherfucker, I answered the question.
You have to send me a link to that interview now.
To be fair, he then asked Samuel Jackson that question. Jackson was awesome about it. He's like, yeah, I'm going to answer it. And he gave these wonderful answers. The problem is Tarantino is a little asshole. He is, and he treats people like shit.
He treats people like shit who kind of deserve it. Like have you seen that interview he does with that film critic who tries
her?
She deserved every
bit
of it.
Yeah, to call her a film critic would be an insult to every film
critic. But she deserved every bit of it, just like that interview deserved
that was different, though. She was being openly... She was doing essentially what's happening on screen. She's doing that to him. Well, the other guy was just asking like basic questions.
Seen that guy interview a lot. He's a dickhead.
Well, what other ones have you seen?
I saw the Samuel Jackson one. I think Sam Jackson was too nice to the fucker.
No, but
that's the thing. If you're interviewing for a fucking movie, what? Okay. Tell me if you're going to interview Robert Downey Jr. My God!
It's a white guy.
A white guy in a Marvel movie? No. No.
Hey, calm down. You're gonna get Tumblr angry.
Uh-huh.
But, okay, but David, let me ask you this. Uh-huh. If you, like, let's say you have a career, and in your career, you are definitely a respected journalist, okay? Uh-huh.
Yeah.
But here's the thing. You are going to interview Robert Downey Jr., but okay. The subject is he's promoting Avengers.
Uh-huh.
Do you, even though you're a respected journalist, but your job is to interview about Avengers, do you ask about that incredibly dark period of his life that he's documented, or do you go, you know what?
Well, that's the point. This is
about a fucking superhero.
Well, that's the part I agree with, that I don't think that those questions were appropriate to ask him for this, you know, promoting the film. That I do agree with. But it's one of those where if, you know, for me, I would actually probably interview him about the film itself, relating to you portraying the character a lot, all that sort of thing. That's well and good. It's just that I feel that there was a time and a place to do the interview, and I know that where he's coming from, that he does ask, like, you know, harder questions and such, but the thing is, when it comes to that, then I wouldn't ask those questions.
And that's like, if that guy wanted that kind of an interview with Downey Jr., are you telling me that he isn't a big enough a deal on Channel 4 where he could have said, you know what, I do would like to do this press interview, but I would like to also book a huge interview with Robert Downey Jr.? If he wanted that kind of interview, are you telling me he couldn't have done it? He couldn't have gotten what he wanted? And that's the thing you get when you look at journalists, especially in this day and age. Journalists are fucking weaselly vultures.
Yeah, but haven't they always kind of been?
They used to, but they tried to hide it before.
You'll have to send me a link to that Tarantino interview.
Oh, here comes something awesome.
Yeah, it's Kobe Smulders.
I thought her last name was just Smulder.
Oh, Smulder. I always think of How I Met Your Mother whenever I see her.
Yeah.
And how the entire show was about how he just wanted to have sex with her. And that was it.
That was a horrible finale.
I never really watched it after, I don't know, the second or third season. It just became like the same thing over and over again.
It's a really good show. It is one of the fun bits about it is like that you begin to think about, well, what if my life was a little different? What if this happened instead of that? It's actually pretty cool when it comes to those things. But the thing is, it turns out that the last season we get to see the mother, and you actually begin to fall in love with the actress playing the mother. She's really good.
She's also in A Wolf of Wall Street.
As yes. Yeah.
I didn't watch the finale. How did it all end? Did he find his wife?
Yeah, and at the end, it's like,
did he meet the mother?
Yeah, and then they meet, and then she dies.
Oh, that's depressing.
Yeah, and then he just...
Is that why he's talking to his kids all the time? He's like,
yeah,
I'm going to talk to you for 10 years about how I met your mother and how she died.
Yeah. And all the women
that's bullshit.
Yeah, and of course they're like,
yeah, and all the women he fucked along the way.
Dad, this is the worst abstinence talk ever.
Did she, like, die in childbirth?
Wait a minute.
Because he has two kids.
No, she died when they were, like, 10, I think, or something.
Hey, is that Clifton Collins Jr.?
Where?
In playing the doctor? Is that some... I don't know why.
No, it's David Tennant playing the doctor. David Tennant is going to be joining the Marvel Universe, though.
Wow. As what?
He's going to be on the next Netflix show, a.k.a. Jessica Jones.
Oh, okay.
As, I can't remember his first name, but his last name is Kilgrave. And he's called Kilgrave the Purple Man. And his power is to essentially influence you to do anything he wants.
Hmm. Well, he doesn't need any power to do that, Thithter.
Especially not at conventions. Holy shit.
Woo!
But yeah, the thing is, I'm happy that David Chen's going to be a part of it. But I'm also kind of depressed because that means when they do get the Fantastic Four back, he can't be Mr. Fantastic. I still hope that when Marvel gets the Fantastic Four back, geez. I'm keeping my fingers crossed for Natalie Dormer as Sue Storm. She plays a Marjorie Tyrell on Game of Thrones. The woman who is engaged to Joffrey.
Mm, yeah.
And when she's blonde, she always kind of...
Wait, isn't she playing Jean Grey?
No, that's Sophie Turner. I'm talking about the older woman.
Oh, okay, gotcha.
She's also on that Sherlock Holmes show, Elementary.
Mm.
I think she was Moriarty. I don't know. I don't watch that show, but somebody told me she was Moriarty. Are you looking up Natalie Dormer?
Huh? Oh, no. Wait, who's Natalie Dormer again?
The woman that, if I were to cast Fantastic Four and
Marvel. Oh, wait, she's the... Okay, I know who it is now. That wasn't very kind.
And just like with what they're planning on doing with Fantastic Four, or not Fantastic Four, but Spider-Man, I do the same thing with Fantastic Four. and not have them do an origin. Just have them kind of explain who they are and have them already be established. And the reason we had never seen them before is that they've been in space doing Fantastic Four shit.
Your work has been a gift to mankind. You shaped the century. And I need you to do it one more time.
I want a haircut. Please. No. Now you see, Cameron, he's the guy who looks like a Linkin Park fan. Not the Joker.
Oh, no, that's a metal arm, not ugly-ass tattoos. If anything, he looks like he could be an Iron Maiden. And everyone knows that an Iron Maiden fan could kick the shit out of a Linkin Park fan.
Even if they're 65?
Especially because they're 65. They're fucking crazy. I really can't wait to see what that guy's going to look like as Crossbones.
Oh, it's Total Recall.
Yeah. What kind of women are you attracted to?
You blew my cover!
Slutty women.
I am not.
I really want to see that new Arnold Schwarzenegger zombie movie.
I saw that trailer and that looked pretty good.
Wait, Arnold's in a zombie movie?
He plays a guy whose daughter is infected and he's trying to protect her in the apocalypse. Like, from what I hear, it's like really, really good, and people are saying this unironically. It's the best acting job Arnold Schwarzenegger's ever done.
For which one?
In this movie called Maggie.
Really?
Like, people are saying it unironically, like, he gives a literal good performance.
I don't think the council's accepting my call to you. What's that?
What's that?
They'll triangulate with inside satellites becoming fully recognized.
I wonder where Joss Whedon came across Cobie Smulders, because don't get me wrong, but she's never been in anything he's done aside from Avengers, right?
Not to my knowledge. No.
And usually that's how. Usually, whenever you see people that are in his troops, they're in something beforehand.
Maybe he's just a big fan of How I Met Your Mother.
No, because he knew her before then.
He did?
She was his choice for when he was still on Wonder Woman.
Well, when was How I Met Your Mother?
How I Met Your Mother was before. How I Met Your Mother was after Joss was trying to put together Wonder Woman.
Maybe he saw a picture of her and he's like, ooh la la.
Son of a bitch. I do what he does, just slow.
That's racist.
Well, I'm willing to bet you there's an entire Tumblr page about how this movie is racist. All because the Falcon isn't the star of the movie.
But why would the Falcon be the star of the film? It's called Captain America.
Because I'm talking about Tumblr, David. Tumblr doesn't have any kind of logic.
We looked for you after. My folks wanted to give you a ride.
Here's another good scene.
Yeah, I love when they bring back skinny Steve Rogers. It is nice to see that.
Another touch I like from the first movie, I don't know if it's, I don't think it's in this one, but in the first movie, whenever you see Steve kind of taking time for himself, especially at the after that USO show, where he's just kind of doodling, in the comics, one of the Steve's day jobs, when he was trying to keep both Captain America and Steve Rogers as separate lives, was as a cartoonist.
My name's Buck, and I'm ready to fuck.
Where did that come from?
Is that from Kill Bill?
Yeah. Why?
Is he called Buck?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Short for Bucky.
Yeah.
Although Bucky's got to be short for something else.
His full name is James Buchanan Barnes, so Bucky comes from the Buchanan.
The Buchanan. He's the kind of stuff. Bartholomew.
Bart. Barf. I like this.
I love this. I love that they bring this back.
Oh, so great. He's going to wear the old uniform?
Yeah.
Oh, cool.
No, he's going to wear the old uniform.
Oh. Okay, that's probably the best Stanley cameo, right?
You haven't seen him in Age of Ultron yet.
What did he do in that one?
Remember what?
I'm trying to think.
Thor's. Remember Thor's liquor?
Oh, right. Yeah.
So wait, so he's on the bottle of a liquor?
No, you'll see, that's good.
I will also say this.
I'll say this
at the party.
He's the bartender.
Everyone's friends are invited, including Captain America's friends.
Yeah.
And his friends are the people that he knows that are still alive from World War II.
Yeah.
And Stan Lee's plays one of his World War II veteran friends. And I think we also saw Dum Dum Dugan, the guy with the derby. I think he's one of the guys in there. But it's obviously not the same actor. Because there's one guy with like a hat, with a weird hat on.
Oh, I'll have to see it again. I don't remember that.
Oh, you're going to have to see Age of Ultron again.
I'll have to see it again.
Aww.
It's good. It's not great, but it's good.
I actually think it's great. The only part of that bugged me was that, fucking spoiler, montage right at the beginning.
I thought that threw me off
so bad.
It was all right. I didn't.
But the movie is so good, it got me right. Yes!
I love that outfit.
And that's what I like about the Age of Ultron outfit. The Age of Ultron outfit is pretty much
the Age of Ultron. I think that's my favorite outfit they've done for Captain America. It's the Age of Ultron one. It looks really good.
And here comes Captain America's hero speech, which is badass.
You son of a bitch.
I am Iron Man.
I'm good at calculation. But I did not calculate
that. Where's that other guy from? The Indian-looking guy. He looks really familiar.
I wanted to say he was from Lost, but I don't think he's from that.
I know I've seen him other stuff. I just can't remember what.
That entire room is filled with character actors except for Jenny Agutter.
Yeah. Oh, he's in Age of Ultron.
Yeah, he is.
I just noticed that. Ah. Because I remember they show him and I'm like, why are they focusing on this guy so much? That's why. Oh. It all makes sense now. Freedom cost a buck.
Freedom isn't free for folks like you and me. I know this is obvious, but there is a cut of the trailers for both Captain America and the Winter Soldier set to America. Fuck yeah, right? There have to be.
I certainly hope so.
There was one for the first Captain America. They did. Yeah, that was hilarious.
Awkward. Yes, sir. I'm just trying to remember like my man, password.
Oh man. Like, man, oh man, I think you're Hydra.
That's the same sound he makes when he calls Agent 13 on the phone.
You know, wouldn't it have been smarter of him to be like, okay, no problem, and then, like, type something in that'll shut the computer down?
I like that gun she's carrying. That doesn't look like a standard gun, either.
Yeah.
It's huge. It's bigger than she is.
Yeah, if this was, like, a slapstick movie, she would fire it and be sent launching backwards.
Oh, God. I just peed my pants. Someone shoot the screen so he can't do it. Whatever.
I really can't wait to see him as Crossbones.
Crossbones, what do you mean?
Okay, the character's name, he's Romler or something.
So wait, he lives this? He survives this movie?
Well, they've already announced.
Wait till the end.
Oh, well, they. Well, I don't. I'm not gonna say I'm the one who spoiled it, but because they've already announced he's in the cast for Civil for Captain America.
Oh, okay.
So I don't give a shit. That's not, as soon as they start announcing who's gonna be in the next movie, then I can no longer consider a spoiler.
Yeah.
But Crossbones in the comics, like I've said, he is a mercenary for that works pretty much exclusively for the Red Skull.
Huh.
And is he just has this really simple costume. It's black with like a with either sometimes it's with a crossbones on his chest, sometimes it's not. Mm-hmm. And his face mask is really just a skull.
Huh.
A purely white skull.
Do you think they're going to do that for the movie?
I hope so, because it's one of those costumes. But then again, Marvel's really good with how they adapt costumes.
Well, here's they could put it on one of those just kind of face cover masks, like a ski mask kind of thing, and it would look cool.
Well, that's essentially what it is in the comics.
Oh, okay. There we go. Perfect.
That's good luck.
Oh, God. I think Captain America right now, it's a type, and I'm talking strictly on costume, Nathan.
Mm.
It's between his costume.
I do like the Cavill Superman outfit.
I wish they.
But I like the Captain America.
Oh, the Captain America costume is great. Like, it figured out how to perfectly do everything. It's like there's no Marvel costume that even comes close. Even though I do like how Elizabeth Olsen looked as a Scarlet.
I still don't understand why they don't give fucking Captain America a gun anymore.
Isn't it
like he had him in World War II?
Isn't it on his side? Doesn't he have a sidearm like on his holster?
No. Wait a minute. Though.
He never does, and even if he did, he never used it.
Hold on. He did get that suit from the museum, so maybe there just was no sidearm put on.
Yeah, but I mean, why wouldn't you give Captain the same thing happens in the first Avengers movie. He never has a gun, and why the fuck not? He's Captain America. If you're on the streets of New York fighting aliens, you really should have a gun to shoot at them instead of just throwing your shield around. And there's one moment where he picks up an assault rifle that one of the bad guys dropped and starts shooting, and I'm like, oh my God, Captain America's back. Because he shot shitloads of people in World War II, and now he just only uses his shield, and it's...
Oh, Jenny, go gut her!
Yeah. She trained for months for this movie.
Especially this part that's coming up. Like, only certain actresses can do this. It's really hard to learn how to do that as an actress.
Dun, dun, dun.
Mm, yeah, I get that red hair out. Mm.
Did I step on your moment?
She can step on my moment.
Ah, you fucking...
So wait, what's his superpowers? He just flies around like an idiot?
You shut your fuck... Get the fuck out! Go! Go right now! You do that shit! You fucking fly around, you piece of shit! You fucking cunt!
See, now Falcon gets guns. Why doesn't Captain America get a gun?
Oh, in case you're wondering, in the comics, he can also command falcons.
Oh, okay. He hasn't commanded those falcons yet.
Kind of like Aquaman does with
Sea. Yeah, and if you're going to talk shit about Aquaman, we'll take this outside. And that goes for anyone listening. You don't talk shit about the Falcon. You don't talk shit about Aquaman. You want to know who talks shit about Aquaman? Comedians who think they're fucking funny. Not even Dave Chappelle does that bit anymore. And it was his bit. So fuck off.
And for the record, the idea that Aquaman can control sharks is actually very scary. So.
That needs bulletproof. Like, I showed you that comic where there's this one scene.
Yes, I remember.
Where
this.
Aquaman's in front of like this bank robbery, and the robbers are laughing like fucking Aquaman. So he lifts up his trident, flicks it, and then stabs the grill of the truck and suplexes the fucking armored truck. They get out, shoot him, and it's a machine gun, so it bounces off his chainmail armor. One strikes him in the head, and it just causes a scratch, so he's like this. And then he gives him a look like this.
Actually, I really do like the secrets being revealed. That's, I like her. That's forever.
Aquaman's a fucking badass.
Captain America's fucking badass.
Oh, yeah. There are very few heroes I think are completely and totally shitty. Like, I think the Barry Allen version of the Flash in the comics is a shitty character.
Who's the original Flash?
The original Flash is a guy named Jay Garrick.
Okay.
Barry Allen was the second Flash, but he's the guy that has the iconic costume.
Mm-hmm.
The huge red jumpsuit.
Well, how's he shitty? That's iconic.
The costume
is great, but the guy inside of
it. Yeah, he's a typical Silver Age boring guy who they never gave a character trait to.
Okay.
He was just like, well, I just want to do the right thing, but without any of the charm that Superman has to go along with it, you know?
So he's in like that, the heroin guy.
Heroin guy?
You know, the kid, what was
the name? Oh, Speedy.
Yeah, Speedy ended up getting Speed, right?
Yeah, and the most interesting thing about the Flash were his villains. And then the third Flash was Barry Allen's sidekick, Wally West. Oh, that's cool.
Okay. All right, okay, I'm going to give him a little... You know, he's not flying around like an idiot. He's flying around.
He doesn't fly around like an idiot ever. You watch your fucking mouth. He never flew around like an idiot. Oh, what'd you fucking do it? You sit in your fucking tower.
You kidding? I did it this morning.
You sit in your fucking tower like you're so much fucking better than people. Fucking, fuck you.
Jeez.
Oh, another comic character who's fucking horrible. I don't get why people.
Oh, Jesus!
Fuck.
That's like almost like a tip of the hat to the Raiders of the Lost Ark.
Yeah.
Thing. Another superhero who's fucking boring as shit is the John Stewart Green Lantern. The guy from the only reason people like him is because he's on the Justice League TV show. He's boring as shit. The two best Green Lanterns are Kyle Rayner and Guy Gardner. And Kilowog. And the only
so who is it? Oh, you sneaky
It's Vader!
Bitch.
It's time! It's time! It's Samuel Jackson time!
You sneaky bitch.
Did you get my father? I'm glad you're here.
It's weird how much I dislike Barry Allen, but I really like the Flash TV show. Because they give Barry Allen pretty much all of Wally West's characteristics.
Because you're the best, the most ruthless person I've ever met. You are the attempt. Our enemies are your enemies. The sword.
You know who's an underrated character? Cyclops.
It's a matter of time before a dirty bomb goes off the monster.
Are you gonna talk shit on Cyclops now, David?
What? No. Are you kidding? Like,
all he does is wear red glasses around like an idiot.
Yeah, but he can blast people to death. You kidding?
Falcon can fucking fly! He doesn't need a jet.
Yeah, but yeah, here's Cyclops. Hey, there goes that doofus.
Yeah, you want to know what Falcon can do? A fucking barrel roll.
And what, he's not going okay, with that optic blast, Cyclops has got his number.
You knock the glasses off of him, he's...
Yeah, but then he goes all over the place.
He won't. Because he could hurt somebody that's not his target. Boom! Fucking blew you up.
Yeah, but he could blow everybody else up in the way.
But he wouldn't.
Yeah, but what if somebody just kept...
Okay, now you're saying someone...
This part's gross, by the way. Ew.
Oh, that's cool. I love that they built that up.
Okay, but David, now you're changing the rules so someone is attacking Cyclops to force his eyes open on somebody else. You're changing the rules of engagement. So if you're doing that, Captain America joins Falcon, beats the shit out of whoever is doing that to Cyclops and Cyclops.
Yeah, but then if somebody's going to fuck around with Cyclops, then somebody else is going to join.
But you change the rules first.
But who's to say Cyclops is going to close his eyes?
Why would he endanger...
What if he has a sneeze?
Why would he...
I have to...
Have you ever sneezed and kept your eyes open?
Yeah, but one of those, like, you jerk back and your eyes open sometimes.
You're conscious enough to keep your eyes shut if you're trying to.
Yeah, but then, like, you have that reflex.
Look, just face it. Falcon's awesome.
Director, is this ruined?
You weigh a little more than 108.
Oh, really?
You weigh a little more than 108.
See? Pew, 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 pew.
Oh.
And I have news for you. Winter Soldier could fuck up Cyclops, and I like Cyclops. Oh, look, he's got a parachute. Blowing you up again, David. Don't you ever fuck with Falcon.
Aww, that's what you get for stealing the cookies.
I'm glad my parents found out about my party, bro.
So does Gary Shandling show up again, or is that it?
He makes a very quick little appearance, yeah.
Like he gets arrested or something?
No, you see him in prison getting raped.
it's the post-credit scene.
And it's Thanos. He goes, want to guess what I'm going to do with the Infinity Gauntlet? He looks at Gary Shannon and goes, hey,
So, folks, I know that when it comes to making a joke about rape, it's a very touchy subject, but I think we did find a joke.
Thanos looks at him and goes, hey, want to be my Infinity Gauntlet?
Oh, God.
Wear me like the gauntlet.
Get a haircut, hippie.
That is something Captain America would say, isn't it?
Well, here's the question, though. Get a haircut, hippie.
What he just said is something Captain America would say. Please don't make me do this.
No, I was going to ask. Wasn't it established in the first film that he can't get drunk?
Yeah.
Okay, so if he smoked weed,
what would go through his system?
I'm sure he wouldn't be affected.
It wouldn't. Yeah, just like technically Wolverine can't get drunk either for the same reason. And here's a stupid bit of nerd trivia. The main reason Wolverine drinks beer is so
the
he
taste.
Can, no, he so he can stay afloat in water.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Because technically because of the metal in his on his bones, he should sink like an anchor. So he just constantly drinks anything with carbonation in it to kind of keep him afloat. Which
shit.
I don't think has any basis in science at all.
I'm sure it doesn't.
Just
that
like,
sounds completely like made up bullshit.
Oh yeah, just like somebody once asked, I think it was answered by Stan Lee, but somebody asked the Hulk writers this question: how come whenever Hulk changes, you know, Bruce Banner changes into the Hulk, his pants are always purple? So Stan Lee answered, "Oh well, see, it's the gamma radiation; it changes whatever clothing wearing into purple pants. Whatever pants he's wearing into purple because of the gamma radiation, just like it changes his skin green."
That's fucking stupid.
But it's Stan Lee, so it has that Stan Lee charm. You know what I want to see in a solo Hulk movie? Joe Fixit. Joe Fixit is the Hulk when he's gray. When the Hulk turned gray, he lost a lot of his strength. Yeah, like that.
Apparently he was cut out of Avengers 2.
Who was?
He was supposed to have Gray Hulk in Avengers 2.
Why?
It's probably in a deleted scene. There's like...
Why would they do that?
It says Gray Hulk almost made an appearance in Avengers 2, but Green Hulk was far too popular to lose.
Well, why would they have Gray Hulk, though?
I'll look it up real quick. I'll read the story real quick.
You want me to tell you what happens to the Hulk in the movie?
Oh, jeez. He broke his arm.
Oh, I see. Yeah, that makes
sense. So why did he do it?
Everyone wanted the green guy in the end. ILM just changed his eyes to make him look more sullen.
Oh!
When is that? Okay.
Oh, so they weren't even going to give him the Grey Hulk's personality. Because in the comics, the Grey Hulk's personality is essentially, he's the pig-headed machismo guy.
Yeah, when was it going to be in the Avengers when he would do that?
But no, but that's the thing. They weren't going to give him, from what Nathan just said, they weren't going to give him the Grey Hulk's personality.
No. I don't know about personality,
gray?
Yeah, the Grey Hulk has a unique personality.
Well, why were they just going to make him gray then? Just
do you want me to explain what happens to the Hulk?
Do you want to spoil it to you? Or
doesn't
do you
he,
see
doesn't he fall in love with Scarlett Johansson?
No, that has nothing to do with that.
That doesn't have to do with that.
What happens?
Wait
a minute, I know what happens. Does it have to do with Scarlet Witch, like, screwing around with
him?
Yes. Okay. So basically his brain gets fucked up for a little bit.
Okay.
They were going to have him be Grey Hulk for that, but then decided against it because I guess they liked the green too much. I don't know. So they just changed his eyes a little bit instead.
And I think that's kind of cheaped out. Because if anything else, and I hate to be thinking like this, but if you want to make toy sales...
Yeah. Oh, God.
One thing I thought was kind of weird about Avengers 2 is that you never saw the Hulk change. There's one point where you see him change from Hulk back to Bruce Banner, but you never see
Bruce Banner
to Hulk
man,
change.
David's into this. Like, no, don't!
We've been talking over the whole movie, and he's really into it. That's how much this movie is. That's how awesome this fucking movie is.
But the thing is, when he's Joe Fixit in the comics, first of all, the world thinks he's dead, so the Hulk can start over.
Please tell me he has a big tool belt on.
No, he's a mafia leg breaker, so he dresses up like fucking Goodfellas and shit.
Ah.
And he has a normal, like, you know, white tux.
But would the world know that something stupid is happening? Like, wait a minute here.
When you live in that world, though, with gods and monsters.
Yeah.
And but get this, he has a black black suit, a white tux, like James Bond tux, and then of course he has a Hulk suit, which is purple with blue pinstripes. And he goes by the name Joe Fixit. And when he's gray Hulk, he only turns into Hulk at night. When it's the daytime, yeah, the sun burns his skin, so he has to become Bruce Banner again. And Hulk desperately tries to get blackout drunk. Or drink enough to make a guy Banner's size blackout drunk,
shit.
And he turns back.
Oh shit!
Bruce Banner has to sleep off the entire day, when it hits night again, he can just be the Hulk.
Time to go boom boom.
And boom goes the dynamite.
You know what? I wonder if they'll ever do this in the. I can't imagine the situation in which they would do this in a Captain America movie, but U.S. Agent.
Huh.
And U.S. Agent's costume is essentially Captain America's costume, but black, and instead of a star on his chest, the chest is just an entire flag.
Iron Man 2? Yeah, it was.
Iron Man 2? Fuck that movie. I got this movie.
Oh, his frail body. Wake the fuck up!
see the way she wakes up first, it's like Scarlett Johansson's like raising an eyebrow, so I thought she was gonna say some kind of quip the first time I saw this.
Well, she did. She said those really do sting.
But I'm like talking about being more alert, like she's kind of faking it.
Well, you see, this is if Joss Whedon was writing it. She'd be like shocking development.
See, David hates Joss Whedon. David hates Joss Whedon.
And then she looks at him and she goes, electrifying.
Okay, are you talking about Joss Whedon or Akiva Goldsman?
No, Akiva Goldsman would be like, you're not taking me into the electric chair.
No, that's a first year spring flex line.
Aww. No, that's a London Boyd script.
Jesus Christ, David!
I kid, London.
Like, you weren't here for the last commentary.
I was not.
Did you hear it?
I have not. I haven't listened to it
David
yet.
David was going after everyone who has ever done him wrong.
Of course he was.
Nah. But you know what? We're focused on some good stuff here.
Let's watch Robert Redford die.
Like a dead Robert Redford, exactly.
Which is probably going to happen pretty soon.
Aww.
He's getting up there in age. How old is
he? Who do you think is going to go first, him or Stan Lee?
Stan Lee.
Probably Stan Lee.
Stanley
seems a lot more frail.
You know what shocked me when we were doing the death pool for this year? Mm. Bob Dole is still alive.
Oh yeah, he is. Wait, you did a death pool?
Yeah.
Okay. What about Christopher Lee?
Oh, I put Christopher Lee on mine. Yeah.
When do you think he's gonna die?
I bet for him to die this year.
Really?
Yeah.
Aww. I hope he never.
Okay, that's not me saying I hate Christopher.
I know. Well, he is 93 this year. Oof. Actually, I think his birthday is this month. If not already, so happy birthday, Mr. Lee. Or Sir Lee.
So I guess sometime this month we should watch one of his Dracula movies. I have Prince of Darkness.
Oh, yes.
Which I would say is his best Dracula movie.
Although for him, he'd be like, don't watch any of them. They treated me like shit. You heard that story. Oh, I'll say that story when we do the Dracula bit, but...
How he really is Dracula? He is my favorite Dracula, though.
Nice
shot. He did a good bit. He's a... I like that.
Stop talking shit about Falcon.
Yeah.
I will take you to the dry cleaners, which means I'm going in raw.
He's still a hero. I still hate you. Ow, my leg!
Yeah, you're Captain America. I'm supposed to kill you.
You're famous. Can I get your autograph?
Aren't you Famous Dave's, the barbecue guy?
Yeah, ace death asshole.
Now, from watching this, Tumblr created tons of pictures of these two fucking.
Are you serious?
In those costumes too?
Do you think... Okay, you want to know the fucked
up... Why am I surprised?
It's kind of like Star Trek fan fiction. There's a lot of Kirk Spock getting it on in Star Trek fan fiction.
And here's the thing. These two fucking is not the most fucked up things I've seen. I've seen fucked up pictures of Superman fucking his younger cousin, Supergirl. By trying to find the particular picture of Superman and Supergirl on Tumblr, like, I want to find the cover of Supergirl's death. And I get those two fucking. All of a sudden, you know what? I want to get a good picture of Batman and Robin. And I'll find a good picture of Batman and Robin. Then I'll find one of Batman trying to fuck a 10-year-old boy. Fuck you, Tumblr, and all you fucking...
That's the internet for you.
Fuck fan fiction Tumblr bullshit. I mean, it's not like Tumblr can't be used for good stuff. Like I said, I found a lot of rare art that I never would have found otherwise. Mm-hmm. But it's just, and also good fan art. But I just don't want to see, you know, Wonder Woman in the middle of 18 cocks.
What?
I would.
I also don't want to see...
Oh, that's a good shot.
I also don't want to see every one of the Hulk's personalities but fucking Bruce Banner. I don't want to see that. So unfortunately, I fucking have.
Unfortunately, you can't take it out of your brain now.
Yeah. Oh, God, I even saw this horrible picture because I decided, you know what? I want to see if I can make myself a good Nightcrawler. You know,
not the Fellowship of the Ring.
And when I say Nightcrawler, I don't mean the great Jake Gyllenhaal movie. I mean the great X-Men. I wanted to make a Nightcrawler wallpaper, and I got a couple good pictures. Then, of course, there was one picture where Nightcrawler was fucking himself in the ass with his tail.
Again, that's the internet for you.
Yeah, so...
Okay, who wants that? Okay, I'm not going to judge...
Apparently, at least one person.
Is this going to lead to, like, a little drawing of, like watery sex between Steve Rogers and...
What do you mean, is this going to lead to? It already has!
Just having sex in a pool of water?
But here's the thing. I'm not going to judge anybody for saying, you know what, I'd want to bang Nightcrawler. Because, you know, things are fucked up enough where, yeah, I could see people being attracted to Nightcrawler. He looks like a vampire, blue, all that shit. But wanting to see him fuck himself in the ass with his pointed tail. His pointed fucking tail? Are you kidding me? I am just so happy I haven't found really disturbing.
I'm gonna have to quote Ed Wood again. Eddie, what kind of a movie is this?
Oh, and call
there
back
it
to
is. Call back to the beginning. Yep. Call back to the list.
See, that's the thing. When I grew up, I had I had no idea. When I was like five or something, I had no idea there was a Bucky. Do any of you guys remember the action figures? Since it is Free Comic Book Day, they had Secret Wars action figures in the 80s.
Oh, I remember those.
The first one. I had Cap. I had Falcon. Those are the first two I ever got. So I always linked those two together. Then the comics I got from my brother, those two are the ones that were... those two were partners at the time. So I always figured it was the Falcon and Captain America. Those two were best friends. And, of course, they were. I also had Spider-Man. I had the awesome-looking Doctor Doom.
I do like that they give little PSs to all these characters to see where they go after all this shit goes down.
Yeah, he goes to...
It's a nice thing.
I remember... Keenan was asking me about Winter's... Oh, there's Crossbones.
Uh-oh. He's got the big X.
Yep. So maybe his entire face will be a skull. But I was talking to Keenan about this and I said, you're going to love Winter Soldier. Gary Shandling actually does something useful in the Marvel movie. And he goes, aww. Because Keenan actually likes Iron Man 2 and I can't figure out why. Well, no, I kind of understand why, because he saw Iron Man 2 before he saw Iron Man 1.
Even then, Iron Man 1 is so much fucking better.
Well, that's the thing. He didn't have the standard to kind of compare Iron Man 2 to.
I don't know. If I saw Iron Man 2 first, I don't know if it would make me want to see the rest of them. I'd be like, okay.
And the thing is, and I don't want to fault him for his reasons, but he likes it because it made him laugh a lot. I'm like, that's great, but if I want to laugh a lot and I want to watch a Batman movie, I'm putting in fucking Adam West. Because that's intended to be funny. When I watch... Even then, when you watch any of the Adam West Batman stuff, the villains have one up on Batman so many times. That's what half these shows are about. They half the shows end with Batman and Robin about to be fucking murdered. there's no point in Iron Man 2 in which I think Tony Stark's in any kind of danger.
Because you need me, America.
However, there are so many times in Iron Man 3 where actually I love...
Oh, yeah. He doesn't have a suit or, you know, things are fucked up.
He gets his ass kicked, and that's why I like it.
Yeah.
That's what Justin Hammer should have done to an Iron Man 2. Just hack this costume to take it over. Since they're clearly never going to do Tony Stark as a drunk in the Iron Man.
So, I have a question, though. Since S.H.I.E.L.D. is gone, what are they... White Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., are they going to call it something else now?
No, they deal with that. This came
out... Yeah, they deal with that.
They deal with that. So to the point where Agent Coulson and his selected Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., so once they lose the actual S.H.I.E.L.D. program, they decide to try and rebuild it from the ground up. Mm. No Hydra influences.
So how does Nick Fury come back in the Avengers 2?
Now here's a nice... Now look at the gravestone. There's a nice little callback to a previous Samuel L. Jackson movie.
Yeah.
The Path of the Righteous Man. Which isn't an actual Bible quote. It was just made up by Quentin Tarantino.
Because he's a dick.
Because he's like, yeah, I'm that good. I'm going to rewrite the Bible.
Because he ripped it off of a Sony Chiba film.
Sony Chiba?
Sonny.
No, you said Sony.
I know. Sonny, Sony.
Okay, so you hate Joss Whedon. You hate Robert Downey Jr.
No.
You hate Quentin Tarantino.
No.
You hate the Bible.
No.
And for some reason, you went into how much you dislike the Jews, which I don't really feel comfortable with.
Oh, boo.
Not
going
with
them?
No.
Not
staying here.
You know another thing?
You can come to my house, Black Widow. That's where you can go.
Yeah.
Oh, that's an... I keep forgetting that David hasn't seen Avengers Age of Ultron, because I wanted to mention another thing I love about her in Age of Ultron.
Wait, well, here's the thing that I don't understand. When people were going like about, ooh, her and Steve Rogers.
Huh? What?
What with her... What was that on the thing?
It was information. All the information she can get on Bucky, I think.
Yeah.
And Sharon Carter is the real name of Agent 13.
Okay, here's the thing.
Oh, okay.
I never thought...
So it all comes back around.
I never thought that they're going to be like...
And look, they part with a friendly kiss on the cheek.
Yeah, that I never understood the whole, ooh, we're going to be, you know, ooh, ooh la la. I never thought that.
Oh, I can tell you where they came from. Fucking Tumblr! Tumblr has this idiotic thing on there called shipping, where it's like, I want these two people together so much! And it goes from
fiction... They turn to Mickey and Minnie?
No, that's just my impression of everyone who does that shit on Tumblr. They go from... And they go from fictional...
I like the way they end this movie, too, on the last shot. It's a nice touch.
Now...
Sweet.
Boom! Now, traditional, through Marvel movies, we're gonna have to stick through all the credits.
Yeah. Which can get annoying sometimes.
Wow. That's pretty cool.
I know. I love these end credits. Yeah.
Didn't they first start these kind of end credits with...
Captain America?
Yeah, because it kind of feels like...
No, Iron Man had an end credit sequence.
Oh, yeah.
Iron Man 2 did not...
That was cool. I love that.
I bet this would have looked great in 3D. I bet it was if I saw this movie in 3D, this end credits was the only thing that would have looked
cool. If you had seen this movie in 3D, it would have looked like a Zack Snyder movie.
I would have, yeah, exactly.
See, that is the one thing I will actually completely take Man of Steel to task for.
Is that it looks horrible in 3D?
No, I didn't fuck. I will never see. Judge Dredd.
Because you and me had to see it in 3D because we had the advanced passes, so we didn't have a choice.
Dredd is. If I had a choice, I never would have seen it in 3D.
Yeah.
But here's the thing. When you see on-set pics of Henry Cavill's Superman suit, it's bright. It's vibrant. So, I hated...
Did you see the YouTube video about the guy who changed the color temperature?
And,
it looks
so much better, but you can tell also that I respect the guy for trying, but there are some shots where it goes too far, especially when it comes to the sky. If things start to look less real, as far as background goes. But... Here's my issue. It goes all the way up to Warner Brothers. There's like a Warner Brothers exec who actually said this. Aww. Well, movies about DC heroes are much more serious and grounded and darker and edgier than Marvel movies. To which I said, yeah, that's why Marvel's kind of fucking winning.
Yeah, exactly.
Because here's the thing. Marvel and Kevin Feige, I've heard his name said both ways. Mm.
Gotta be careful with that last name.
He 100% understands that a Captain America movie can't have the same tone as an Iron Man movie.
There you go. Lead credit sequence.
Oh my god!
Isn't there also an after credit sequence too?
I can't remember. Yes,
there is, but it's not really important.
Yeah, unless you want to watch it. The thing is, we usually watch these movies.
We usually get through all the credits anyway, yeah.
I can't believe like that. Oh, I can't say anything.
Nice little Avengers callback. Mm-hmm. What's this character's name? Is it Baron something?
Baron von Strucker.
Baron von Bad Guy.
Yeah.
No, in the comics he looks even. In the comics they completely evil look by giving him a red claw gauntlet.
That's awesome.
Yeah. And he's completely bald.
I know I've seen that guy in other stuff. I can't remember.
In the comics, imagine a beefed up. For comics, von Strucker, imagine a beefed up Blofeld. With a red claw.
Gotcha. Now, technically, they're mutants. These are the only characters Marvel also owns the rights to are in X-Men.
Yeah,
Even though they first appeared as villains in the X-Men, for most of both these characters' existence, they've been Avengers. They were initially members of the Brotherhood of Evil Mutants.
Yes.
Then they wanted to, in the comics they turned against their father at the time, Magneto. Mm-hmm. And Captain America decided, I'm going to give these kids a chance. Everyone deserves it. In fact, the second Avengers lineup is made up of people hand selected by Captain America to give a second chance to. Mm-hmm. Hawkeye was originally a criminal, mm-hmm. who Captain America decided to give a second chance to. And so were Quicksilver and Scarlet Witch.
Okay. Now, but also,
and I would even go far as that Scarlet Witch is even more known as Avenger because there have been times when Quicksilver has gone back to join his father or has been on an X team. Scarlet Witch is the only one of the twins who has never been a member of the X Men.
Oh, that's Stan Lee. Look, he got billing over those other folks right under Delphi Jones. But no, it's when it comes to, because Quicksilver was also featured in the same year as this, as, and yep, there's
Scarcity.
Now, here's the deal. Like, how were they able to do that? Here's the deal. With Days of Future Past, they were to never mention, because he's got a sister, but they can never say, your sister is Scarlet Witch, number one.
Yeah.
Number two, in the subsequent Avengers film, he cannot say, oh, Magneto is his father.
Yeah.
They cannot say that they're mutants.
They have to kind of step around.
Well, they're going to be inhumans. That's what they're going to be.
They call them, in the new Avengers, they call them enhanced.
Yeah, enhanced, but eventually...
Okay.
In the comics, they're now officially called Inhumans as well.
Okay. Yeah, but it was but like, the other thing at the time, you can't
they
call
can both be called... But the thing is, I'm willing to bet that because in the credits, Aaron Taylor Johnson is listed as Pietro Maximoff / Quicksilver.
Yeah.
So I'm willing to bet that if Bryan Singer wanted to use Wanda... He could use her and call her Scarlet Witch.
Well, technically he did. She's in the film.
Well, no, I mean like use her and call her by the Scarlet Witch name.
Yeah. Well, does she call... in the film, do they refer to her as Scarlet Witch?
They call her Wanda, but in the credits... In Avengers, credit Aaron Taylor Johnson as Pietro Maximoff Quicksilver.
They
call him Pietro, but they never call him Quicksilver until the credits.
Okay.
But as far as I'm concerned, if they call him that in the credits, he's Quicksilver.
Yeah.
And just like Wanda in the movie is never called Scarlet Witch, in the credits, she's listed as Wanda Maximoff / the Scarlet Witch.
Well,
Captain... This music sounds like Saving Private Ryan. I love it.
So, I guess we have to go to our
Here's a review. Captain America Winter Soldier is awesome. Probably, I would say it's easily the best solo Marvel movie. It might be the best Marvel movie, but easily the best solo Marvel movie. Mm-hmm. Has everything I've ever loved about Captain America in it, including the Falcon. Eat a dick, David.
Okay.
You don't shit talk the Falcon around me, man.
No, and just for curiosity's sake, what's your least favorite Marvel movie?
Iron Man 2.
Jinx!
Pinch poke, now you owe me a Coke.
I jinxed you first.
I did psychic jinx.
So David, even though we were talking over most of pretty much all the movie.
Yeah.
You're still into it? Still liked it?
Oh, you kidding? I was like on the edge, especially at the armored
soul. Wow, look
at
all
stuff.
Those Asian names. Holy shit. I'm sorry to interrupt you.
Good American. Lord. You can tell David was into it because they're like, oh, he shot Captain America! No!
Well, I care more about him than some dope flying around.
I highly recommend.
I'm kidding.
I highly recommend watching the movie again right away without
us
talking over the entire thing. But no, this is, like I said, for me, it's a tie between this and Guardians of the Galaxy for best Marvel movie. Because
I agree.
Each time I watch either one, I think, oh yeah, this is the best Marvel movie. And then I'll watch the other and I'll be like, oh, this is the best Marvel movie. It's a tough choice.
They both took risks, though.
Guardians of the Galaxy took a big risk with casting Dave Bautista, and that risk pulled off.
Did you say Boo or Bautista?
When he's wrestling, he's Bautista.
Oh, even then, he's like, I don't want anything to do with this, guys. Don't boo me. I'm a cool guy.
He's going to be in the new James Bond, too.
I hope Dave Bautista never returns to WWE, just for the fact he doesn't fucking need them.
Who's he playing in? I know he's playing, like, essentially, like, an odd job character.
Pretty much. Mm-hmm. Mr.
Wink?
Hinks or Winks or something like that, yeah.
No. Mr. Wink is the name of the troll.
Mr. Wink is
Hellboy, too.
Mr. Wink is this one porn star who can wink with his asshole.
Really?
You can't?
Mr. Blink?
Well, the thing is, I've never looked in a mirror to check. I assume I could.
So, yeah. Woo!
No, good stuff.
Yeah, it's great.
Good stuff.
Now go watch the Avengers.
You know what I'm really kind of...
Even though it's nowhere near as good as...
Even though I genuinely dislike Barry Allen as The Flash, and I do like The Flash TV show, but what gets me is Flash is one of those weird things, just like Daredevil does, where he has a cowl... And Batman, where he has a cowl, where in the comics you can pull it over your face, but in real life it probably couldn't work. But Captain America nails that right by just making it a helmet with a chin strap. I don't understand why that would be.
Like with Dark Knight and Dark Knight Rises making it more of a helmet type.
Yeah, I don't understand why you wouldn't do that with The Flash.
Here you go, your after credits.
He didn't give the uniform back? Come on, Cap.
Would you want to be the museum director who actually has, Captain America, sir! We need our uniform back, sir! Even though he'll probably...
Bucky!
Even though 100% Captain America probably go, oh, I'm sorry, I just needed to borrow it.
Rock the mic, Bucky.
Of course, when me and Cameron first saw the movie, there's the line where Robert Redford asks Nick Fury to have Iron Man show up at his niece's birthday party, and I turned to him, and we were both convinced that has to be the end credit scene.
Yeah,
like, please, dear God, that would be the best fucking thing ever. So we waited so patiently throughout all the credits, and it didn't happen, which was kind of disappointing. Like, but
sons of bitches.
The rest of the movie made up for it.
Well.
Yeah, this was your turn, Nathan. So, Cameron, can you give us a little hint about what next week's film is going
to
be?
Well, I think what you need to do is get your drink shakers out, get your vodka, vermouth, olives if you want, and be prepared to shake but never stir.
That sounds disgusting.
It sounds sexy to me. Oh, my.
Can you add a little fruit juice in there so I can actually drink it without wincing?
Well, maybe I could put a slice of lemon in there, or just a bit of lemon skin.
Yeah. So, I guess we're going to call this one a day, huh, fellas?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm Cameron.
I'm some guy.
I'm Nathan. We're the Commentators.
Yes. Woo! Bye. Get naked.
Captain America for President. Woo! 2016.
That was actually a storyline in the comments. And he turned it down because he thought that he wasn't worthy of the office.
That's lame.